This is the D6 Generation with your hosts, Craig Gallant.
You're wrong! If you're getting any compensation, it's not charity!
Russ Wakeland. You put me on a boat with freaking dragons attacking me and whatnot? Now we're talking. And Rafe, Hollywood Granger.
Now that's Jimmy Django right there.
With contribution from Total Fangirl.
Vampires do not sparkle.
And our loyal listener.
One game is very like another to the D6G reviews it, brother.
Welcome to another edition of Rapid Fire, the roundtable discussion of all things gaming coming at you faster than a speeding bullet and more powerful than a locomotive. Today's edition is brought to you by a fan of Chris Flip Flories, who wants you to know, what do you get when you combine a balloon twister, a D6 generation fan, and a Whovian? A life-size balloon TARDIS, of course. Go to wheresthetardis.com/entry/350 and vote. You can vote every day until May 15th. Thanks! I'm Geekly McNerdigan, your host. Today, as always, our panelists are Russ Wally West Wakeland and Rafe Gabriel Jones Granger. Let's begin. Issue number one. A superhero is a type of stock character possessing extraordinary or superhuman powers and dedicated to protecting the public. Since before World War II, stories of superheroes ranging from brief episodic adventures to continuing years-long sagas have dominated American comic books and crossed over into other media. The word itself dates to at least 1917. Superheroes is a trademark co-owned by DC Comics and Marvel Comics. Question. What year was the first modern comic book printed? Choose your answer. A. 1917. B. 1925. C. 1933. Or D. 1938. Galactus Granger?
1938.
War Machine Wakeland?
I'm going to go 17.
And the answer is wrong! Ah. It's 1933.
Ah.
A printing company thought that it could get more use out of its printing press by making a small 8-page doubly folded book, which it then filled with little stories.
Huh.
Issue number two.
Cool.
Battle Los Angeles is a 2011 military science fiction war film directed by Jonathan Liebsman. Released in March of 2011, the film is set in modern-day Los Angeles and follows a platoon of U.S. Marines during a global alien invasion. Although professional reviewers have panned the film, which has earned a 33% on RottenTomatoes.com, it has been getting rave reviews from sci-fi fans, veterans, and gamers from around the world. And even on Rotten Tomatoes, the viewer rating is a surprising 65% positive. Question: true or false? Battle Los Angeles is based upon a true story. Riol Russ?
False.
Rigelian Rafe?
True.
Rafe is correct. Wow. True. Russ is wrong.
What was about aliens?
Of course he's wrong.
Not long after Pearl Harbor, an unidentified object appeared over L.A. and stayed there for several hours. The entire city was thrown into a blackout, and searchlights and anti-aircraft lit up the night. Over 1,400 rounds of anti-aircraft artillery were expended trying to bring the object down, but the object stayed afloat and was never found. To this day, those who discuss the event, both in and out of the military, refer to it as the Battle of Los Angeles. Issue number three. Jules Gabriel Verne was a French author who pioneered the science fiction genre. Best known for novels such as 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea and A Journey to the Center of the Earth, Verne wrote about space, air, and water travel before air travel and practical submarines were even invented. He is often popularly referred to as the father of science fiction. However, writing from his place in the Victorian era, his work now seems more reminiscent of what we would call steampunk today. Question. Verne wrote a little-known sequel to his famous 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. Which of the following is that sequel? A. A Floating City. B. The Fur Country. C. The Blockade Runners. Or D. The Mysterious Island. Killer Wang Wakeland.
I'm going to go with Mysterious Island.
Francis Gordon Granger.
Mysterious Island.
You are both correct! The Woo! Mysterious Island, in which Verne reveals Captain Nemo's true anti-British feelings and his own Indian heritage. Early translations into English of this novel actually had those sections removed by the British translator, muddying the trivia waters even further. Issue number four. The term dream can be defined as a series of images, ideas, emotions, and sensations occurring involuntarily in the mind during certain stages of sleep. Ironically, it can also mean a condition or achievement that is longed for, an aspiration. In either instance, dreams can be something to live for. However, there is a famous saying that says there are two great tragedies inherent in the human condition: not attaining your life's dream and attaining it. Question, what is the most common dream among gamers around the world? Carl Rogers Rafe.
Publishing their own game.
Alfred Adler Russ.
Having a basement full of every miniature on the planet.
Wrong! Every gamer secretly desires to sit with Craig watching Russ try to teach something to Rafe that he has no interest in. Who wouldn't want a front row seat to that action? That's it for now. Thanks for listening and good night.
This episode of the D6 Generation is brought to you by
Myriad Games, the friendly professional gaming store of the D6 Generation.
And by Battle Foam, protecting your army so you don't have to.
And by Lone Wolf Development, take your game to the next level.
And the War Store, bringing the war to your door since 1999, and that is for a decade or more.
And by Audible, try the service, get a free book, and support the show. All by visiting audibletrial.com/D6G.
Hello! Hello, hello, hello.
And welcome.
Hey, y'all.
Oh, geez. Welcome to episode 76 of the D6 Generation. I'm Russ Wakelin.
76, man. Spirit of. I'm Craig Gallant.
And I'm Rafe Hollywood Granger.
Nice. We went from Pink Floyd to the U.S. Revolution. I was pretty interesting. So, Craig, let's do Craig. Craig, what are we talking about today's show?
Ironically, some of us are going to be doing an interview. And then later on, we're going to do the contest. We're going to listen to all the contest entries that we were able to decipher. And we will be choosing a winner live.
Yeah. The contest entry might even be first. Who can say? The order is up in the air. We never really know.
I didn't say what order they were going to be in.
Right.
That's right. You did.
So, before we get to all that, though, we should chat up about the whole deal with the contest. So we
should.
So the upcoming contest we're going to talk about later in the show, the one that just ended, beginning of the March.
That's not an upcoming contest.
Right.
We're going to upcoming is us talking about the contest that just ended.
Right. But then we have contests that are an upcoming contest that has not happened yet, i.e. in the future.
And that is the one that's upcoming.
Which we've already mentioned in the past. Back in the Lost Chapters, episode 4. In episode 4, we mentioned this contest. And we're going to talk about it, though, in episode 77. So
That's right.
We have not forgotten about that, for those of you listening to the Lost Chapters. And if you don't listen to the Lost Chapters, no worries, because we'll cover it all in 77. All right?
That's right.
Okay. So no purchase necessary. You can participate in the contest. That's all we're saying. And as always, when you do enter contests, please make sure you send your entries to contest@thed6generation.com. And a little request here from the audio folks. When we do contests with audio entries, such as the one we'll be talking about later today, sometimes we like them in MP3 or WAV. Sometimes you send them to us in M4A, which not all of us can access. I can, but sometimes when we delegate.
But usually I end up doing the collating, and I can't access.
So that would be best if you get them in. Now, don't worry. We got them all in this time, but it would be helpful to us if we.
It would be a huge help.
Single format. MP3
would
probably the best.
It would also help if you name them, your name, and just something in that indicates what the contest is.
Yes.
That would be huge,
That would be
too.
Excellent.
That's a good idea.
All right.
That's for the future.
Now, before we get into achievements, we should say that for those of you following along at home, trying to keep track of what the heck's up with the Lost Chapters, what was the last Lost Chapter about, Rafe?
I don't know, but I know.
Okay. So the deal is, this is what's confusing Rafe, and possibly some of you, because there are eddies in the space-time continuum.
That's for dang sure.
Not
one
only
of them is named Pax.
Right.
Oh, I remember.
Not only is Eddie's couch in his couch, but also the other problem is that sometimes we record these shows out of an order that we actually air them.
Right.
So that was the confusion in Lost Chapter 4. Now, Lost Chapter 5, the latest one, which is already up by the time you hear this, what was it about, Rafe?
Oh, we're up to 5 already?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Believe it. So 5 was the great debate between Russ and Craig.
No.
That 4.
That was 4,
sir.
Didn't
know it.
4. But that's not the latest one. 4 is the last one. The latest one, which is already up, is about what inspires us when we make our RPG campaigns.
That's right.
That came out good, too.
I liked that. That was a good one.
So hope you enjoyed that one. And remember, all the Lost Chapters, you can get them for only $1 over
So 5 is out already?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, it's out.
Wow, man.
I know, right?
So
breaks in the space-time continuum.
Inexorable crawling forward of time.
So you can get those.
I have a tip to help you, Russ.
All right.
With the lost chapters.
Okay.
I see some emails that people say, hey, I'm really excited. I just downloaded my fifth lost chapter, but I didn't get any kind of notification of what to do next. What is there some way that you can air out to people in case that happens what they can do?
Well, no, what's happening is, well, that's not exactly the email we get. What happens is, so there's different ways you get lost chapters, right? You can download them directly for only a dollar. Those folks have no problem. You can also subscribe. Now, when you subscribe to the lost chapters, either through the option of paying $2 a month or by the annual subscription of $24 a year, you will get an email mailed to your address, email address that is attached to your PayPal account that you use to subscribe. All right. So if you, for example, use an old email address with your PayPal account, or your email address is some kind of strange spam filter and you do not get that email, that's when I get emails saying, hey, Russ, I joined up, but I didn't get anything.
Okay.
That's the trip. So if that happens, just email me and I will help you out. But unfortunately, there's no magic voodoo. The only thing I can suggest is make sure you check your spam box is probably in there.
Okay, so check your spam box first, then you can email Russ.
Right.
Is that
and
it?
And also right. make sure that your PayPal email address is up to date.
Okay.
So that you get where you think it was. But thank you, Rick. That would be very helpful. But now it's time for
Achievements in Gaming.
I am right. such a dissident.
And that's an achievement
that is
for
now my favorite
for,
segment.
As someone tweeted, Lollipop Guild is representing.
That's right.
I love that.
We represent the Lollipop Guild, the Lollipop Guild.
Now, what's scary is it requires, for me to sound like that, I have to use strange technology, but Craig could do it all on his own.
I could just come over there and kick you in the hoo-ha.
Yeah, right. Anyway.
No, Craig, when you were saying that, I was squinching my eye and sort of punching, like, near my kidney.
Okay.
Remember that? That's what they do. They, like, squint their eye and they do this little
like,
punch move.
Kind of like Popeye.
Okay.
as they're doing a little jig, yes.
Well, first we should probably, before we get to achievements, Achievements in Gaming is brought to you by Tor Gaming, bringing originality back to your gaming table with the Stitchpunk-themed tabletop war game Relics at www.torgaming.co.uk. Thanks, Gavin. Okay, so Rafe, what have you been playing since last time we spoke?
All right. Well, I finally got to play my own copy. I did play this before of Survive.
Oh, how did that
escape
go?
Escape from Atlantis.
Oh, sorry.
It was fine. That was Lou's birthday present.
What, do you like it?
And he was very excited to get it, and we busted it open, and we played with Nana, Mommy, Lou, and Dad, and Emmy got to play too. And we set the board all up, and we're having a good time. The only problem is Nana didn't really take her meds that day, so she was a little bit over-excitable and wanted to talk about stuff not related to the game, and then complained that she didn't understand how the game was. And Nana has all her marbles, so she can handle it, because we had a blast playing Clue with her last time.
I was going to say, Survive's simpler than Clue.
Oh, God, yeah. So it was kind of annoying. And then what that was doing was honking off Marisa. And so I couldn't get a good sense of if Marisa was having a good time. But see, I like to pick games where, like Russ says, it's always fun to beat Daddy. Well, what Lou thinks is hilarious is to beat Mommy. So I was just waiting for that moment for him to take a sea monster and sink Marisa's boat.
Yeah.
And but that never happened because we didn't actually get to finish the game. So but all around, I think this is a success. People liked it. Emmy had fun rolling the die, moving the monsters. So that was a win.
Excellent.
Have you guys played it since?
Yes, I played it several times with my family. And I've got the Squeeples now, the Squid Meeples, and they're also fantastic.
Nice.
So yeah,
Squeeples.
Yes,
I haven't gotten the Squeeples yet. I want to play the main game for a while. I'm going to skip over the next thing and save that to towards the end. Ooh, get this, super secret. I played D&D Essentials with a super secret crew. We're playing every other Sunday night, and we're testing this out. We're doing a three-game test, so I'm one game in on my three-game test, and we use Fantasy Grounds, Russ.
Well, I knew about your super secret thing because one of the secret guys told me about it.
Oh.
So this
two
is not
of the
a surprise.
Secret guys told me.
Two?
Right.
No. All right, so my super secret party is Dave Farr, Angelo, and Doc Rain.
Right.
Uh-huh. And Doc is the GM, and Angelo did a super duper 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 job. He was the Russ of the group.
That's
so
what Dave
we're
said.
Like, how do we add how do we add our weapon? He's like, okay, right click here, download this, click here. So he had superior knowledge to Fantasy Grounds, and I think that's what made this session successful.
Sweet, because it is tricky. To learn it the first time.
I totally knew what you mean, Russ. It was not exactly that user-friendly, but once explained, it made total sense.
Right, it's awesome once you figure it out. But it takes a bit. Yeah.
Now, Craig, I don't think you've had a chance to maybe check out Fantasy Grounds. I was a little concerned that it would seem like this bulky, computerized version of D&D that wasn't fun, but Russ is right. It totally just adds to the ambiance of the game. The stuff that you do to add the data is really before you play.
Yeah.
The game is sophisticated enough, I'm sure Russ can tell us more, somehow basically where you just basically tell it, you know, you add in the details of your weapon, which wasn't that hard, and then, you know, it knows from the details you added of what your skills are or what your attributes are, there's a way to sort of connect the two behind the scenes. So when you roll your hit, it's factoring in the weapon that's in your main hand, along with your skills, along with your feats. Right, Russ? Or am I overstating it?
No, that's exactly right. So basically, your character sheet has all your powers on it. And you just pick the power you want to do, whether it's a special swing with your sword or a magic spell. And if you've set it up properly and just basically typed in the word for word that's in the rule book, it sort of parses that, figures it out, and does the math for you. It's pretty cool.
So like when you roll your 20 side, it'll say 20 plus 5 plus 2.
Right.
And it's adding in all your appropriate bonuses.
Yeah, it's pretty slick.
It's very slick. I'm playing a druid, and I'm playing a female for the first time ever, role-playing a female character, which is kind of hard, actually.
Now, aren't you also playing a female in Rifts?
Yes, Maribee. It's the same character in my mind.
Oh, look at this. So it's like Stony.
And what's interesting about Maribee is that is a combination of my wife's name, her first and middle name. And it's hilarious because I'm building my character after her. So I'm having this very strange juxtaposition where when I was in college, I had this hamster that I named Bob, which was my dad's name. And I did that on purpose because I just thought it was hilarious that I would be like, come here, Bob. And that was like my dad's name. So I'm playing like this little character version of Marisa. So I'm like talking to her like it's my wife and stuff. It's surreal. It only makes sense to me.
I would love to hear what your therapist thinks of all this.
Oh, yeah. It's hilarious. So, like,
there's a gold mine of years of therapy.
Oh, it really is, dude. It, when I'm playing Riffs, I'm like, come on, honey. You can do it.
I prefer my
spell. It's hilarious.
My wife is a character in a game I control, and my dad is a hamster.
Yes, yes. Russ, you are not too far off the mark, my friend.
Wow.
Dog did a fantastic time DMing. He really set up a good scene. Dave was kind of out of it. He was a little out of sorts. I think the Sunday night caught him by surprise, and he wasn't quite prepared. So he was kind of quiet, and it was hard to get a read if he was really enjoying it. But I had 10 times more fun with this than I thought I was going to have.
Oh, good. Well, achievement for that.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to it continuing. Then we played Kingsburg, mm-hmm. and we played it without the expansion, mm-hmm. and I lost by 1 point. I had an awesome game. But I felt bad for both Brian and Dave because they were in the least positions, mm-hmm. and there was like no way for them to catch up. So the poor guys had to play like 90 minutes with literally no way. Now, it was because it was without the expansion.
Right.
And Dave was saying if we had the expansion, it would have made a difference. Hmm. And then we played Seven Wonders. And that is a fun game, but I was tired. So I didn't enjoy it that much. And then Craig and I were supposed to play Wrath of Ashardalon with Russ. Russ, you know, got us all excited with his 30 minutes, and
yes.
he talked us into it, and
right.
I was excited, and Craig was excited.
Right.
I was very excited.
Oh, I know. I was too.
Well, here's how excited they were. They were so excited mm-hmm. that when it turned out I couldn't make it, because it turned out I had school events for the next 2 weeks with my daughter, so I couldn't
do this. 2 weeks, not even 1 week.
I know. So that was my bad. I totally screwed up my calendar. So when that came up, I said, sorry, guys, I can't make it. If you want to reschedule for PattyCon or sometime in the future, or you can go by without me, you know, whatever. And Craig's like, we're going to go without you because we're all excited to play. I'm like, wow, really? Okay, good. Well, that worked out. So I felt like kind of good because you weren't just playing to, you know, make me feel good. You actually wanted to go forward with it. So, but then I heard how it went, I guess. So what do you guys think? Did it not go so
well? Wait, before we
first for the excitement, I actually took out the game share copy.
Right.
Yes. Yes.
And I read the rules. I learned the rules. I looked at the models. They're much cooler than the Ravenloft models, in my opinion.
Cool.
I also went online. I was looking at blogs, and then I started to find things in blogs that started to put me off initially.
Oh, you didn't tell me that.
Yeah, because I found some blogs that are like, if you don't like this game, then you're stupid and you're an idiot. You don't understand good game. And I was like, seriously? Now, I'm sure there are people out there.
But is it written by the designer or just some idiot on the internet?
No. An idiot. And I'm
because
saying,
I'm here to tell you there are many
say that about everything.
There are many idiots on the internet.
Exactly. But right. Those are the ones I found.
Us included. Like, oh. We are not an exception to that rule. We may be idiots.
No. In fact, we're like certified idiots.
Exactly.
But and it didn't color my enjoyment or lack thereof with the game at all. It was just like, that's weird. But anyway, so what did we think of the game? Rafe, what did we think of the game?
Well, before that, Craig, talk about how the new paradigm bit Russ right in the tuchus.
Oh, it was
that. This was the best.
It was kind of funny because Russ was all excited and he was telling us what we were going to do, and he was
sending
us little
bits of fluff. We were writing fluff for our characters.
Right. We're very excited.
What are your characters? Blah 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 blah. And then a listener emailed me and was like, "Hey, what do you think?" And he's actually a local guy who wanted to come and play a game of Dystopian Wars. And I told him, "Well, you know, who to talk to would be Russ, and you know, and he plays a lot and blah blah blah. But we're going to be playing." Wrath of a Shardalon this week, so maybe he'd be able to give you a game next week, but there's a couple other people, and his name's Ryan. He's a really nice guy, and he ended up getting games without Russ's help. But then Ryan emails me back and goes, really? Because I just saw on Twitter that Russ's wife tweeted that he won't be free because he has some event he has to go to.
Right.
I was like, really? And then there was a huge thread of everybody who was going to play.
Russ is like, I'm so excited. I'll be there this Tuesday. Right.
So then I post an email on this thread. Apparently, Russ's wife just tweeted that he won't be available. Russ, you might want to look into that. And sure enough.
Yeah, unfortunately, I can't really give Twitter credit for that. Actually, what happened was that Ryan was exchanging direct messages with Nicole. And they were talking about things, and Ryan's like, hey, is Russ going to be there Tuesday to help me out? And Nicole said, no, unfortunately, can't make it. So
I can tell you, he said it was Twitter.
Right. Well, it is Twitter. It was Twitter's direct message system, unfortunately. So we can't really give full paradigm credit. But I think it would be cool if we could, because it means that basically the paradigm is so fantastic that the news I have to tell you gets to you without me even having to say anything. That is awesome.
One could say the same thing about Facebook, and I would still argue that that's a good thing.
Of course, I hate to say it, Craig, but I think he proved the point of the new paradigm.
We were alerted
to the fact
want to redefine things like social and good, then yes.
No.
He's right. We were alerted to the fact that he couldn't come before he told us.
You knew sooner than you would otherwise, which is what's important.
Yeah. Oh, it might be what's important to you, but sort of privacy and choosing my time to tell things is what's important to me. But, you know, we're all different. It's okay.
Well, right. If you want to.
Anyway, yeah, so just, we ended up playing. Okay, and
I want to do my one lead in, Craig, and then I'm going to let you explain the details because you're better at the details. I now understand.
Oh, yeah.
Russ is so bored playing Agricola and never really did get it. I knew he didn't like it, but I was like, I don't see why he doesn't like it. I was so bored playing that game. And I'm not trying to bust Russ's chops. It just was not fun. And now I pass the baton to Greg.
Well, I mean, in all honesty, we had what I think is probably a really bad series of events right off the bat.
I think we did.
And we had a bunch of really bad...
Yeah. To be all fluffy.
No, you didn't have Russ being there to affect us with his Jedi mind tricks to show us the way. Right. But we also didn't... I mean... We had a bunch of bad pulls as far as the dungeon tiles went. So the dungeon itself started to shape itself up kind of in going in two separate directions. And we all started to go in one direction. And then a pit showed up. And Dave and I both dropped into the pit. And poor Dave, because of the game, it requires a 10+. So there's a 50-50 chance and there's nothing you can do. Really, I mean, there's a card that lets you reroll if you have like a lucky charm or something, but there's nothing you can do. It's a 50-50 chance to get out of actually almost everything, but this pit in particular. And it took Dave, it was on the fourth turn that he got out of the pit. So our cleric was stuck in a pit for four turns and there was nothing he
could
do.
Which is a good joke right there. That's a great lead-in already for a good joke.
So our cleric was stuck in a pit.
So our cleric's stuck in a pit. Meanwhile.
Yeah. So I was stuck in a pit for one, like I got out on the second turn that I was in the pit. So at least I wasn't in there for as long as he was, but that wasn't very much fun. And then what happened was, the party ended up getting split because of the pit and a couple other traps that showed up. And we kept getting these events that would cause more tiles from the bottom to show up. So more monsters were showing up, and they were in the
so that made the dungeon longer.
It made it long, not only longer, but
now,
it
wait,
ended
let me
up
ask you
this.
How does the tile coming from the bottom make it longer? Because couldn't you just explore a different direction?
Well, no, you still have to deal with the monster that's coming out of that.
We don't have to.
We couldn't. I can't remember why. Ian was off on his own in the direction we were all going. He took a point, and then a series of traps and monsters ended up. He got trapped at that end, and we couldn't explore any further because of like the wave of monsters that was coming up and a bunch of traps you'd have
that's
to go
awesome.
Through.
You got a wall of monsters to fight your way through. Why didn't you fight your way through?
And there was a lava flow that you had to get.
How
I mean, there was a
bad?
Series
that's
of
great.
Things that it didn't make
it
any
just
sense
didn't
to
come out cinematically. It came out annoyingly.
Right. Why?
I don't know. I tried to put my finger on it. I think for me, it was the I'm just too used to Dungeons and Dragons, and so the 10-plus trap thing, it was just too fickle. You know, it was like, that happens. You're going to roll four times under a 10.
But that is D&D 4.0. I mean, I know you guys not like D&D 4.0, but 4.0 introduced the whole concept of the effects not having a fixed number of turns, but instead you just roll, and it's literally 50-50 whether they go away or not sometimes. So
sometimes.
Well, in many cases, right? So I think it's just like that, right? So it's really... There's a story going on there. Now, it could be, because I've been in role-playing games, right, where a player just has really bad luck and never does anything for a whole battle. And he's like, oh, that battle sucked. But usually go back to him and say, wasn't it hilarious when you get stuck in the bear trap and you couldn't escape for six turns and the dragon was coming to eat you and then I had to jump on his back and save you? That actually sounds like it sort of happened in this game, but you're all like, oh, it's stupid.
Yeah, we have a story to tell.
But you could have also, but the same adventure I just described with the bear trap.
I don't know.
It was really dumb. You were stuck in a bear trap for all six turns.
Well, I did try to put my finger on it, and Ian kept getting mad at me because he thought I was, making fun of his game and being
Debbie
Downer.
I think you had three people involved that really shouldn't have been, right? You had you, who obviously went in not wanting to have fun.
No, I wanted to have fun.
Well, no, if you said for the... Well, okay. Then you went in with the attitude I went in going to Agricola. Okay, let's put it that way. Then you had Dave, who you just pointed out in your other D&D game. No offense, Dave, but you're not the world's greatest role player. And then we had Dave... Sorry, but it's true. And then there's Dave's friend, who's kind of new to the whole thing. So you really
had fun.
Well, good. That's good. So you really only had like one or two role players in the party... With a couple people kind of
and
like
I was wrapped up in the rules.
And you're in rule books. So there was nobody actually saying, hey, let's get into the story, right?
Right. And that's
it
why
it just seemed too wooden.
All the things that I didn't like about Ravenloft were still there. The whole abstract thing that we've already discussed for a lost chapter and an episode.
Right, so we
won't have to go over that. But And Dave wasn't having any fun. Rafe wasn't having any fun. I was wrapped up in the rules, so I wasn't able to really inject much character into it. Ian, I think, was feeling outnumbered, so he kind of just fell back on just playing it as a board game. And Dave's friend, Dave, was new to the whole thing, so he was kind of like feeling his way along. So I think, Russ, you're right. But at the same – I mean, even though those people weren't having fun, after – you know how you have to process something for a little bit.
Right, right.
Dave was done saying, oh, there's 10,000 games I'd rather play, blah, blah, blah. Right. Rafe was like, my eyes are burning. I was like, well, I'm definitely not going to buy this. And after like a half hour, Dave was starting to say, we did have a bunch of really bad tiles. We had a really bunch of – it was a huge series of challenging – I mean, what I will say for the game is it's hugely well-designed as far as the balance goes. Because we were getting our butts kicked, but we did end up managing to pull off the mission in the end.
Yes.
Right.
Which, so, Russ, you probably would have thought was awesome.
Yeah, you don't want it to be easy, right?
No. Even Rafe loved the final battle.
The final battle was fun.
Right. So, and after I talked to you guys via email, I said, well, it sounds like you guys don't like it. I'll just find a crew that wants to run with it with me. And, of course, Ian's in on that already. But then Dave was like, well, I kind of want to try it again.
Right. That's what I was
going to
say.
So it's not a total fail, but I really mean
what I say. I know you and I bust each other's chops about Agricola. I really mean that this is my Agricola. I can see why you like it, and there were some fun moments of it, but I'm now like, I get it. Russ really doesn't like building a farm.
Then it's not really your Agricola, because neither of us understand why you like it, and we don't have any fun.
I do.
Well,
I'm kidding.
Right.
But anyway.
So, I'm glad you guys tried it. That's a good effort.
Right. And where I was going with what I was saying is that Dave ended up saying, I would like to try it again because I think this was a fluke.
All right. Well, we'll see. Hopefully, we'll get more play. I'm like I said, we'll all talk about modeling, but I'm really into the game. I like it a lot. So hopefully,
Like to play again, when I'm not the go-to guy for the rules, because I only had the rules for a day. So
right. Well, yeah.
I'd rather be just there to experience it and know my own stuff. And yeah. You know, but anyway, so there's that.
Well, thanks for trying it out. That's always good.
We did our best.
I'll give you an achievement for that.
Thanks.
So okay. So that was Rafe, right?
Yeah.
I've been doing, let's see, what did I get? Well, I didn't get too many Tuesdays lately, but that doesn't stop me from gaming because, you know, I got a game. So first of all, thanks to Out of the Box Publishing, who sent us a copy of a game called Shake and Take.
Ooh.
And definitely a family game. I tried it with the girls. Very simple game. I don't know. I like their other games a lot. I can't.
This one not so much.
Well, here's the scoop. So basically you got this dry erase board, right? And on the dry erase board, a bunch of aliens, and the aliens are all different shapes. Some look like circles, some look like hearts. And you got this die, and you're going to roll a die, and then it's going to be a circle or square or a heart. And as soon as it comes up with, let's say, a circle, you're going to start circling with this dry erase marker that's got a giant, like, foot-long alien, rubber alien on top of it, right?
Yeah.
And you're going to start circling these things. Meanwhile, the other player, i.e. your eight-year-old daughter, has an egg, a clear egg with a die in it as well. And she's shaking the egg, and she's trying to get the die inside the egg is blank on all sides, except one side has an alien face on it. And she's shaking it as fast as she can, trying to get the alien face to come up. And when she does, she reaches as fast as she can, grabs the pen out of your hand, and yanks it out of your hand. Then your turn ends, and then she gets to go. And then you get
the
egg.
Wow, that sounds like a disaster waiting to happen.
So, well, you can imagine. Now, with 2 to 5 players, that's how it rolls. When you get higher than 5 players, because it plays to like 10 players, I think, there actually is another whole set of pens and dice, and you have 2 going on around the table at once, and they can actually catch up to the same player and have 2 going on at once. So it's a little crazy. There's lots of marker on your hand when you're done. These are the guys that make Pirate versus Pirate and Ninja versus Ninja, and those are some great games. This one, I don't know. I guess you could have fun with it. I don't know if I can recommend it, but it's neat. The components are cool, and if you have younger kids who are just starting to figure out their shapes, it might be kind of cool.
Okay.
Now, then, of course, the big thing for me the last couple weeks was PAX East.
Yeah, I want to hear about this.
A gaming con in Boston. Now, PAX, of course, is based on the original con. It's Penny Arcade Expo, the guys that make the comic that's right on the web. And they have an original con, as I mentioned last year. They have an original con that happens in the northwest of the United States.
Yep.
But now they've got one. This is the second year in Boston. And they made a bigger venue, and it was sold out again, and it was fantastic. It was awesome. And the really cool thing about it was that I was surprised. It's mostly from the video game side of things. So the vendor hall is mostly video games. And last year it was almost entirely video games with just a little smattering of board game guys here and there. This year, though, there were many, many more board game people.
Really?
Not like Gen Con level, but Fantasy Flight Games booth was there, all set up. All stuff in it. Steve Jackson was there last year, and he was there this year. There were quite a few more vendors selling board games. And they had a very, very, very massive open gaming area with a board game library you could check board games out of. So it's really nice. Huge area.
Why the change there, you think?
Well, they've always been, the Penny Arcade guys do occasionally cover on their comic strip War Machine and 40K and those other games, and they play them. So the Expo's always sort of had that, but I think what they've had now is people organizing it are pushing that a little more now, so there's more room. And I think also this venue, last year it was in the Heinz, this year it was in the BCEC, the Boston Convention Expo Center, and that one is our event center. That one's even bigger. And because they had more space, they're able to have more of that kind of stuff. So
somebody, I think it was on Major Nelson podcast, the Xbox podcast, that they visited NERD, Craig, the New England Research and Development, right, for Microsoft.
Yeah, they actually, I got to
called
go there.
NERD. That's the best.
Yeah, I got to go there. Last year, I got to go there because they had a special event there before the show.
And the Surface, right?
Yeah, this year they didn't have their thing there, so I didn't go. But it was really cool. The whole PAX thing was fantastic. I was really surprised with the miniature games, and it was kind of fun. On Sunday, I brought the girls, my daughters, to their very first con. I brought them down
Sunday,
to PAX.
Sunday.
Cool. And it was cool because got to play shooting ladders with them. Kurt Covert was there, by the way, his crew.
Of course.
And Geek Chic was there last year. They were there as well. I get to say hi to Kurt. The girls love shooting ladders. They had not played that one before. They played Run for Your Life Candyman, but they had not played shooting ladders. Loved that one. And the other big thing was Soda Pop Miniatures folks were there, and they had a bunch of stuff on display, and they had their new game coming out this summer called Super Dungeon Explorer.
Yeah, I remember seeing these models at Gen Con. I like the little chubby models.
They're very cutesy. They kind of look like something the people who would draw Pokemon or Final Fantasy, the video games type stuff. It's that very cute little anime thing going on.
Yeah.
So it's not for everyone. It's not even for me, really. It's just too cute for me. But my girls loved it.
Cool.
Very cool. The little models, they love the idea.
Well, I would argue that they are the target market for that particular artistic style, as opposed to Shifty, who also loved it.
Well,
no, I like the look of it.
There are guys.
And Rafe.
Yeah, there are adults who swear by Final Fantasy and that kind of stuff. So,
this is even creepier than Final Fantasy.
But anyway, so they're cool and they have little, and it's basically, it's basically a Space Hulk style game in that one player runs the dungeon, the other player runs the heroes. That said, though, you can certainly make a team base. So three guys can run the heroes, and one guy can run the dungeon, or you could go two versus two and different monsters. What's kind of neat about it, there's these little spawn points. So it's almost like Gauntlet, where there's spawn points on the board that spawn certain monsters, and then you go in and break the spawn points. But it's basically a dungeon crawler. It's very cute. Models are fantastic in quality.
Would you play it without kids involved?
I might. But I don't know that I'd buy it if I didn't have kids. If Will had it, he's like, let's try it out, I would. But I think without kids, I think it's more, for me, it's more of a family game. My girls love the concept of Descent, and they really like Ravenloft. And but I think that they don't like painting some of the scarier models. I think this really hits it because they've got little cute little, you know, Pokemon-style looking bad guys, right? So the kobolds look like something you see in Pokemon kind of thing. So they love that kind of stuff. So I think it hits the mark perfectly for a family game. So I think it's going to do well. And there's a certain genre of gamer who also likes that. So I think it's pretty well positioned.
Okay.
And they did tell me that they're going to be releasing it. They're extremely confident they'll be releasing a Gen Con 2011 this summer. So if you are interested in this, it will be there.
And what was the overall convention base where people like, oh, what the heck is this weird stuff, you know, coming from the computer game side? Or are you finding that a video gamer and now a board gamer, there's almost no divisible line?
Well, no, there is a division, but I think what you've got going on is the board gamers, like right next to that area, there were miniature war games tables set up, and there were 40K events going on, and there were War Machine events going on, and there were some people demoing War Machine, and there were open play War Machine, and there was tournaments. It wasn't anything like TempleCon is with terms of that, but there was some of that going on. There was no down your nose looking from the video game guys.
Right.
Because the video game, the thing to remember too, even the video games, right? There are video gamers who would look at like Pokemon and Final Fantasy the way Craig looks at this, right? There are guys who plays Gears of War and Madden Football who look over at the guys playing the Pokemon games like, what the hell are you doing?
What are they doing?
You're a grown man. That's for your daughter, you know? Uh-huh. And then, And vice versa, there's people who play Pokemon like, how can you play a game with so much gore and guts, you know? So, and somehow, though, at PAX, we're all gamers. And no one seems to, that doesn't seem to happen so much. I didn't see any of that at all. It was just, you're in line, you know, people be in line to the new Star Wars game, and they're standing next to someone in line of Pokemon, and they're like, what are you waiting for? Oh, Pokemon, cool, you know, I'm going to check out the Star Wars thing. There was none of that going on. So it's just, we're all gamers, we're all geeks, we know it, and we're going to have fun. So,
did you get to check out Star Wars?
I did. Well, okay. So the line to see, I was going to put this in other, but we'll put it here. The line
well,
to
you
see,
also talked a lot about it in the news.
I did. Yeah, episode. I did. So
it's
but,
actually went to quite a length about it.
Yeah. So it was a long wait. It was awesome.
We'll give them the 30-second version.
Yeah, it was really cool. Definitely more story driven than most other MMOs I've seen. Full voice acting. There's like Mass Effect little dialogue wheels. Very, very cool looking. We'll see what happens. But the lines to see it were incredible. I would say it and pretty much it was one of the biggest to see games at the con. And so we'll see how it does. I mean, it's still going up against WoW, but it is Star Wars and it's BioWare, so we'll see. So that was my PAX related to miniature gaming and board gaming. Good times there. So Craig, what else did you do? Did you play any Epic, Craig?
I did play Epic. I finally got my Epic game in against Matt and his Necrons.
Nice.
This is the same game, the same Necron army that we talked about briefly in the last Achievements in Gaming that blew Will out of the water, and he didn't kill a single stand, and he quit the game before even it was begun. Mm-hmm. I managed to kill a bunch of stuff, and One of them being the pylon, which apparently is like a big target and can't do all that much. But it's really scary looking, so I decided I needed to kill it.
Nice.
I killed Nightbringer, which was huge because he brought Nightbringer in on top of my – I have a squadron of three Shadow Sword super heavy tanks.
Yeah.
And they were on my flank. They were going to, they were the ones who finally killed the pylon. So they were kind of like, in a normal game, they're kind of like, I point them at something and that's what I want to kill this turn.
Mm-hmm.
Not so much against Necrons. Against Necrons, your Shadow Sword may as well be a Leman Russ. Because all of the cool, it's a super powerful weapon gets totally ignored by the Necrons. So, like, they get two saving throws. I mean, it's crazy. They're fearless, so it doesn't matter. So there's all. It's one of those armies that kind of ignores a lot of the basic rules of the game. But it was a lot of fun because Matt's always a lot of fun to play, and he won handily. But that final score was 2-1 as far as objectives went. So I wasn't crushed completely.
Good.
And I did make some mistakes that I knew. As soon as I made them, I was like, oh, crap, I did that instead of that. And he would go, no, go back and do it. And I would tell him, no, A, I want the game to, you know, I want it to be a speedy game. And B, the burned hand teaches best. I'm going to remember this at Adepticon when I think, oh, yeah, he crushed me because I did this the wrong way. So
right. It
was a lot of fun. And all my new terrain was on the board. So now the board was super terrain heavy, and not a single piece of it was the piece of that was the terrain that I've been using for the last 2 years.
Wow, achievement for that.
So now I have enough terrain to completely fill up two totally different boards.
By the way, speaking of the Necro Gamer, I was thinking about this when I was listening back to episode 75 about Dead Games. You, my friend, are keeping Epic alive.
I enjoy Epic.
That is quite old game that some would call dead.
Well, I think, and they would be well within their rights. But I think Matt and Will are both definitely carrying their own. I don't think it's just me, but we do enjoy our Epic, and Tim has joined in now lately too. So
right, nice.
So yeah, so that was my the game this week, and I wanted to get in another game of Dystopian Wars, but we all decided to go to dinner instead. So we all went to dinner and had a really nice, relaxing dinner at La Coretta, at all things.
Well, plus, you didn't have a whole half a day to devote to Dystopian Wars. So after that.
It doesn't really take a whole half a day.
Oh.
I would argue Epic probably takes just as long.
It does. I would argue that if you're playing at any reasonable speed, Dystopian Wars takes about the same amount of time as any other miniature game you care to name of similar size.
I would say the same.
Yeah.
All right. So what about modeling? Ray, have you done any modeling?
Nope. Zipola. And I'm starting to freak out because I got Adepticon coming up.
You better buckle down, son.
I got a job done.
Speaking of Adepticon, I just finished all my vehicles in my Adepticon army.
How does that make you feel, Rafe? See how I did
now,
there?
Not only that, Rafe, but, I already had all these models painted, but I had unpainted versions of them all, and I wasn't super happy with the paint schemes, and I knew going to Adepticon I kind of wanted to bring my A game. So I just doubled the amount of vehicles that I have because I painted a whole new set of vehicles for this army.
Wow.
And I loved it.
Dang.
A whole bunch of the terrain that I finally painted up is the JR miniatures terrain that's kind of like clay.
Mm-hmm.
Really not very good quality.
I like their buildings.
I was really disappointed. These are the buildings that I'm talking about. They're very each model was very wildly varied in the quality, and some of them lean to one side and some of them are miscast and I bought a bunch, so I have a huge cross section to go by, and they look fine now that they're painted, but I was not overly impressed, let's say that. And I am in the process of painting a whole bunch of S6 engineering roads, rivers, and building bases from England.
Yep.
Because I have all these awesome buildings and they were always just sitting in the grass and I didn't really like that. And so I got a huge order from S6 Engineering. And you go to their website and look at all their stuff. They have 28-millimeter terrain and roads and stuff, and they have 6 millimeters. Actually, it's 6/15 millimeter. The river looks like it's a little small even for 6 millimeter, and the roads look like they're a little big for 6 millimeter, but perfect for 15 millimeter for like Flames of War. But I bought a ton of it. And I'm painting up, like, I have enough roads to bring a road into the middle of the table, have a city that has 10 buildings in it, and have the road leave the other side of the table.
Wow. For that.
So that's a lot. And I'm doing the roads with, like, yellow lines down the middle and white dotted lines on either side of that. And so it's very, very exciting because it looks cool when it's all painted up. And that's what I've been doing for modeling.
Well, I'm doing a little modeling. I sprayed all my Wrath of Ashardalon monsters. Got
them
all primed.
You got it right. Yay.
I know, right? And then I actually painted a couple. I got the easy ones, like the bears. You know, you dry brush them brown, hit some claws, teeth, you're done, boom. So, yeah, that's been good. But then I just wanted to bring this up in modeling. When I was at PAX East, I saw this War Machine table that I had to pick my jaw off the floor. So, and the pictures I put, I got pictures up on Facebook, and I put some in the show notes for you guys to check out. The pictures don't really do it justice because there's so many lighting effects on it that the camera doesn't really capture well. So these guys, they're from this little group. They call themselves At-Large Gamers, and their names are Richard, Mark, and Seth. So, hi, guys. Nice work on the table. When I say lighting effects, I don't mean like they painted the lighting effects. I mean they were actual working glowing lights. So if you look at this little oil rig here on the website, you can see that you see the lights glowing in between the things. And what was cool is next to the clock tower building, there you see this little jack on the left-hand side there. And the jack had wires going into him, and he had a backpack with all these switches on it. And you could flip the switches and change the colors of the lights on throughout the board. So like when it was player A's turn, you could make it red. And then the Signar player's turn, you could make all the lights green kind of thing or blue. But it was even cooler than that. Like every element you needed to play the game was somewhere built into the table. So like the clock tower was actually a turn counter that could also be a game timer.
Wow.
There was a dice tower built into the water tower. The board was all modular, could be reconnected. But here was the craziest thing I'd never seen done before. First of all, there was a little fog machine also that filled the room with fog. But the thing I'd never seen done before was he put sensors. He has these objective markers, and they all look identical, but in the bottom, some of them have different proximity sensors in them, okay, glued in. Then that special jack that has the things on it, it's got a sensor in it too. So as you're playing the game, when the jack gets near one of the objectives, it detects it, and all the lights change on the board to like explosion mode, and you get your objective. It's like, wow, that's really cool. So I got to give mad props to these guys. That was some crazy modeling and a really impressive-looking table and some really impressive-looking technology going on there as well. So it's pretty neat.
The basic layout in the ships reminds me of my Mordheim table.
Yes, it does look a lot like the Mordheim. And if you can see, it's hard to see, but all the it's actually six sections that are modular. So that whole table can be rearranged however you want, which is kind of neat. It's pretty cool. So check out our Facebook page at facebook.thed6generation.com. You can check out these pictures in bigger resolution. So you can see all that. So what about other guys? Rafe, what have you been doing besides modeling and miniature and board gaming?
Well, some others have played some Castle Crashers with Lou, having a fun time with that, just going through the levels. That's an Xbox arcade game. I've been enjoying the new MMO Rifts, and it's got some unique stuff, which I talked about in my Hollywood Minute. And, you know, it's been fun. I've been playing with Will and Brian Ahern and Michelle Ahern and Don. So it's been fun to play with people locally. I haven't had much Lacho time because Rifts has been taking over the time. But to be honest, I haven't had much MMO time. I pretty much just kind of come home and like take care of the kids and hang out with the family. Then I like crash or I'm doing the podcast.
Nice.
I'm really having an urge to play Dragon Age 2, Russ. I've really intrigued by that article, and I really want to check it out. If I had Gamefly, well, I would be getting that.
Have you played the demo yet?
No. Is it I can get the demo?
Oh, yeah, the demo's free. I would play the demo first because
that's a great idea.
It's sort of like a Shadowrun. It's not that different from the last one. I mean, it is different, but it's not.
It's not that different?
Well, it's not different in that there's a lot of talking to people. There's a lot of very deep story to try to follow. And, you know, if talking to people and following story is not your thing, that hasn't changed. The combat system's better, but there's still a lot of,
when I read the article and it said it was more single player minded, I thought that meant on having to talk to your party members too.
Well, I'm not talking about party members. I mean, talking about in town to everybody, NPCs, whatever.
There's tons
and tons of dialogue.
I like the dialogue with the NPCs.
Yeah.
What I always felt bad about was when I'm standing around in camp and I'm sort of just scrolling through trying to understand what armor to sell and what not armor to sell, and you would always talk about, that's when I talk to my party member, blah, blah, blah.
That's easier now because you can't change the armor on your party members.
Oh god!
So some of that's easier.
Yeah. That's the kind of stuff that.
Well, try the demo. Try the demo and see what you think. That's what I would say.
Then this is a weird thing that's been going on. Mm-hmm. So Lou decides. So we had the Wii for Lou, right? So he decides, I don't want my Xbox anymore. I want a Wii. All my friends have Wiis. I want a Wii. I want to play Mario Kart. I want to do all these things. I'm like, really? Not going to be able to play Madden, Lou? Nope. I want a Wii. Okay. I don't think he wants a Wii, mind you. Mm-hmm. So he's 10. So I think he's old enough to learn. You know, if he makes mistakes. So what do? We trade in the Xbox, all his materials, all his everything. Okay, get this crappy return rate. And we buy, we take all the points, all his games, all everything. And we buy a Wii. A week later,
I miss my Xbox.
Yeah.
So he's lost like tons of money. Now, this is all his money. This is normally his money he gets from birthdays and stuff like that.
Right,
so I think he's, you know, he's been on my Xbox ever since.
Right.
You know, playing Castle Crashers. So we're, we has to save up a little bit. Luckily, it was his birthday. And so he's got, he's kind of timing it right. So we traded the Wii back in for a huge loss. And then now we're, you know, getting the Xbox again. Of course, now we won't have a hard drive. He doesn't have enough money for a hard drive.
Right. Well,
jeez.
Yeah, my girls, we borrowed a Wii not too long ago to try a Mickey Mouse game we thought was going to be good. And then
I remember the Mickey Mouse with the paintbrush.
Epic Mickey, yeah, and our girls, they played it for like a half hour and didn't like it.
Oh, and he claims he cannot stand the Kinect. Hates the Kinect, wants to trade in the Kinect. He's griping about the Kinect. I'm like, Lou, the Kinect is not yours. Yeah, Santa gave it to me. I'm like, no, he gave it to the family. Well, how come it was wrapped with my name? I'm like, shut up. Gave it to the family. It's not yours. We are not trading it in.
So Dad likes to connect, apparently, but he doesn't.
Well, you know, it's not like I'm playing Dance Central every other day, but I do like the technology behind it. And didn't I hear you saying that like a Star Wars game's coming out with lightsabers?
Yeah, there is. But I still play a lot. I'll get to that, Mike. But yes, there is a Star Wars game coming out this summer, I believe, for the Kinect.
Yep. That's my story. So I'm not allowing myself to play or buy Dragon Age until I finish Red Dead Redemption.
Good policy.
Mm-hmm.
Achievement for that.
Now,
mm-hmm.
What are you doing, Craig?
I'm reading The Wise Man's Fear, which is the sequel to The Name of the Wind, and it's friggin' huge.
Very good.
I'm not convinced it needs to be as long as it is. There are sections of the book where he goes on kind of side adventures, and I'm kind of like, it's like 50 to 100 pages of side adventure, and halfway through I'm like, okay, I get it. I get the point. He's learning A, B, and C. Let's get back to the main plot. So I'm not sure it needs to be 1,000 pages long. I'm enjoying it, and I love the story, but I'm getting a little frustrated with these side trips that the author is taking. I'm getting all wrapped up, oddly enough, in Firestorm Armada again.
Oh, good.
A whole bunch of pictures of the new ships came out.
My fleets are ready, baby.
And I got to tell you, man, there is a whole bunch of cool stuff coming down the pike for for the Firestorm Armada guys.
In fact, I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to say Firestorm Armada is not dead. There's my prediction.
I think it will be revived.
Good. It's resurrecting right now as we speak.
Just like they're coming out. The way they're doing it is amazing, too. They're coming out with free PDFs. They're adding like 20 new races to the game.
Nice! Oh, it's awesome.
And it's like the two major alliances in the game, the quote-unquote good guys and the quote-unquote bad guys, are each getting supported races with their own ships, with their own aesthetic, and their own. It's just, it looks really cool.
Excellent.
So, I've been all excited about that. And of course, I'm starting to brainstorm for the big Adepticon Death Watch game that we're going to have.
Yeah.
So very excited about that. Looking into the possibility that maybe Rafe and others might be able to play Inquisitor characters.
Yeah,
if they want to play Space Marines.
I just started to think about that today, and I'm like totally psyched to make an Inquisitor character.
Yeah.
Hey,
if you allow that, that'll
Craig,
be so fun.
Craig, I have a tip. A great way to challenge an Inquisitor character.
Is a mudslide?
Well, I was going to say, hit him with moist moving earth.
Ha, ha, ha.
That's like kryptonite to those
guys. It is.
I can't help it, Russ, that you're just a one-dimensional gamer.
I am. I love it.
Ouch. And,
I love my mudslides.
Role player, I should say. Role player.
And, of course, preparations are heating up for PattyCon, so we're very excited about that.
Right.
That's this weekend. Having a whole bunch of people coming, descending upon the house. And
are you... Is there going to be a sort of centralized, not theme, because it's Paddy
St. Patrick's Day.
But is it, are you coordinating anything? Are you running
Last year I did the Hunger Games version of Descent, and that went over well, and Fantasy Flight was really cool, and they, through Ross, they sent us a bunch of cool stuff. This year I didn't try to do anything like that, so I didn't solicit anything like that, and I'm just going to enjoy and have fun and play games.
Because
last year I spent most of my day running that event,
right.
I'm actually just looking forward to playing games and hanging out with my friends and eating awesome food.
And then you hire somebody to like cook the chicken so you're not stuck behind the grill the whole time.
Exactly. Or let's say you're not having chicken, you're having corned beef and cabbage, and your wife loves cooking, so you're all good to go.
Win.
Winning. That would be Craigalon winning. Anyway, okay. Well, somebody's going to bound to do it sooner or later. So that's me for other.
Didn't have to. All right, so moving along. Yeah, quick little gamer dad note. I'm going to take an achievement for this. So two big first experiences for my girls the past 2 weeks. First of all, they were all excited. They've gotten into Pokemon. And what they got excited about, Kit, for her birthday money. She had all her birthday money up. She really wanted to get the Pokemon Black game for her DS. This is the big thing. Big new hotness released on last Sunday or Sunday ago. And Rose got the white, and my niece and nephew each got one, so they're all doing the trading thing. But this is the first time they actually wanted to get in line to be there when the store opened to get their video game.
Wow.
And we're waiting in line, and like the GameStop guys are out there with their little handing out coloring sheets for the kids and donuts, and we're waiting. And Kit gets to the front. She's the next person. She literally squeed. Eep! She said, it's like, oh, here we go. I got a gamer. And then
you were looking around going, Will?
Will, yeah, right. Like,
Will?
Exactly,
Will. And, Will wants to play Pokemon Black?
And then last Sunday, I took my kids to their first gaming convention at PAX, and they had a blast. So kind of excited about that. So don't be afraid to take your kids out and get us some gaming. Now, speaking of, Rafe, you mentioned Dance Central.
Yep.
So fantastic new song just came out for Dance Central. Weapon of Choice by Fatboy Slim. Are you familiar with this song, Rafe?
Nope.
All right. So Fatboy Slim, this freaked me out because, A, I love the song. But, B, it features the most fantastic music video ever made by man, which is the Christopher Walken music video to Weapon of Choice. Have you guys seen this music video?
No, but I love Christopher Walken.
Do you remember the song? Because here's a little. Here we go. Ready?
Oh, I've seen this.
So yes. I remember the song. And have you seen the video where Christopher Walken dances to the song in a hotel?
Yes, yes.
And he flies around the room. Okay, so that's fantastic. So I was like, and I'm picturing myself as Christopher Walken the entire time. It's awesome dancing to it. So it's a great way to work out. But here's a little thing I discovered listening to the song again today when I was doing my dancing, which, by the way, unfortunately, in easy mode, you don't actually do any of the Christopher Walken moves. I was kind of hoping for a flying sequence. I did not actually fly. A little disappointing there. But if you are a listener, have not seen the Christopher Walken video for this, just go to YouTube and search for Weapon of Choice.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, you know how I want to meet Susan Sarandon?
Yeah.
I might want to meet Christopher Walken ahead of that.
He's a cool guy.
Have coffee with him.
But here's a little thing. Here's a little bit of trivia. Did you know there is a classic sci-fi reference within the lyrics of this song?
No. I've never heard the song, so no.
Hey, a little more hint. Here we go. Now, Rafe, do you, at Trivia Challenge, for any of our listeners or you, do you know what the classic sci-fi reference is in this song?
No, I have no idea.
Here's the hint. If you walk with no rhythm, you will not attract the worm.
Oh, that would be Dune.
Yeah, there's a recurring lyric several times in the song. Kind of cool. Guy's a Dune fan. Very cool.
Yeah.
And finally, for my achievements, Dragon Age 2. So this is interesting. This actually hit me today. I've been totally enjoying Dragon Age 2. And it's not a perfect game by any means. There's some issues. They did this.
What are the issues?
Well, they... some things people aren't going to like. Like, for example, the last Dragon Age, right, was the classic, epic, Tolkien-esque story.
Yes.
Of dark forces of evil invading the world, about to wipe it out, and you, the lone hero, shall save the day through your actions, and you slowly save the day, which is fine. And that was kind of cool because it was a very classic RPG with classic systems. Made sense. But it's been done a million times, right? Well, this time, a couple things. First of all, instead of going around the entire continent and saving the planet, you're just a person fleeing the tragedies that happened last time.
See, I like it already.
And you're still a kick butt hero. I mean, the very beginning of the game, you kill an ogre. It's still awesome, but no one knows who you are. You don't really have any kind of major destiny, at least that you know about. And you just cast ashore in this new city that you've never been to before, and you've got to work your way up from nothing.
I love it.
Yeah, it's fantastic. I like that kind of thing too. The problem is,
No.
I like that kind of thing. I like to be able to advance, though. I don't want to live my entire campaign as a window washer.
After 100 sessions, you'll be a space marine.
Right. So what's cool about this is that what's neat is that the way they tell the story, it's backstory, right? So in the demo, you'll see this too. The very beginning, there's a storyteller that's saying, I will tell you about this famous person. But when the game starts, you're not anybody. So you don't really know. In the beginning of Dragon Age, in most storybooks, in Tolkien, for example, you know what Frodo's mission is. You know why he's going to be important. You don't know how he's going to do it, but you know why he's going to. In this game, you don't even know what your place is. You're just doing random crap, and then eventually it sort of starts to make sense. The random things you're doing start to come together, but you got to pay attention to follow the story very carefully. So I think some gamers are like, it's just a bunch of random stuff. I don't get it. You know, it's like, well, it's a different storytelling thing. What I find really like is in last, Craig, did you ever notice last time? You mentioned, Craig, that, you know, there's really not very many good, hasn't been really good sci-fi or fantasy or game or movies. Good game movies in a long time. And as I was playing Dragon Age and watching the ship come into the city for the first time, and it pans back and it shows everything, and there's this great dialogue and hilarious one-liners and really epic feeling and tough decisions to make about slavery and right and wrong and what do you do. And I was like, that's what this is. Video games are now where all the good sci-fi and fantasy stories are. Uh-huh. Like, I would argue that Mass Effect is probably the best original sci-fi story in the last 10 years in any medium. And my theory
Craig's
is
not buying it.
No, I'm just saying it's a shame.
My theory
for me.
Well, and I think that's also why they make the games dirt easy now. Like, they all have this easy level that is dirt easy.
I love the easy level.
And I think that my theory is this: video games now make more money than any other entertainment industry.
Yes.
And so I think that all the good writers and idea guys are over there.
I don't.
Well, that makes sense.
Plus, because Hollywood is always retreading crap, and they don't want to try anything new and weird. So I think that's where it all is, and so that's where all the good stories are. So I'm like, why am I so, like, totally, like, this game's found my soul? It's because there isn't anything else like that in video anymore. The only way, I mean, sure, there's great books, but the only way to get it in a video format, i.e. a visual and audio and surrounding experience, if you will, I think is through video games now. Because there hasn't been a really good sci-fi or fantasy movie original concept in how long? I mean, really, think about it. So anyway, that was what I was thinking about it. But I really enjoyed the game. I think it's fantastic fun, And it's definitely different.
Do you think I'd like it? Do you think it's different enough that would keep my attention?
Here's the thing. Play the demo. If you like the demo, I think you'll like the game. But like I said, you got bored with Red Dead Redemption. So I think it's hard to read you because you're more of a, I think you're, let's put it this way. You enjoy comic books.
Right.
I think MMOs are the comic book of an RPG.
And that I would agree with that.
The stories are very short, very clean presented, and not overly complex. You only get so many words you can use.
And there's a lot of squirrel activities. I can run over there. Oh, I can do this. Right. Oh, I can do
Dragon Age, these RPGs, these single-player RPGs, which is what Dragon Age and Mass Effect are, these are more epic movies or novels. So in those, if you're in the mood for a 500-page novel, then fantastic. But if you're really in the mood for a Spider-Man comic, this is not a Spider-Man comic.
Gotcha.
So that's what I would say about that. So, but anyway, I really, really enjoy it. Again, it's not the greatest game of all time, but if you like the first one, you'll love the second one. Go check it out.
Very good.
And that, is that achievements?
We are done.
Worlds to conquer, foes to vanquish, violence to sow, and medieval crops to reap. The whole world of gaming at your fingertips. The D6 generation. Born to game.
Oh, well, you know what that sound means, folks. That's time now for
Lone Wolf. That means a wolf is dying somewhere out in the wilderness.
Somewhere a werewolf has had babies. I don't even know what that image looks like. But we're not talking about. We're not here to talk about werewolves having babies.
Lone Wolf development.
That's right. We're here to talk about the best software for gamers on the planet. A lot of our sponsors are like
game
that.
To all, the next level.
All of our sponsors are the best on the planet. That's what we love about them.
Yeah, that's true. Actually,
and you know, they just came out with Army Builder 3.3 Release B. As in better than release A.
Oh, I could download that.
Fixes a lot of important bug fixes. So if you have little tweak issues, that's great. They're always on top of this stuff, making sure the latest and greatest is there for you. Also, if you're a Hero Lab fan, so Hero Lab, again, remember, helps you create cool characters for your D&D and other, well, any kind of miniature war, or, sorry, RPG. But the licensed games, including Pathfinder, they're adding a bunch of content from the latest supplements, including the Inner Sea World Guidebook, as a free update to the Pathfinder package. So if you already own Pathfinder package, now you can just get the free guides for that. And don't forget Card Vault as well for organizing all your collectible stuff, whether it's cards or miniatures. And
I got to tell you, man, this new download is just sweet. I mean, I have Army Builder, as you know, because I'm using the list building for Adepticon.
Right.
And, you know, all I did was launch the program. It said, hey, there's a download. Yep. And it says click here, boop, taken care of. And then if you want to see what the downloads are, so it's automatically detecting what games I already have installed. Mm-hmm. I mean, what lists I use for which games. And it's just picking those out and just downloading them.
Yeah, keeping you up to date, keeping you ready to rock.
Yep.
So that's it. So we're almost development. Keep your miniature wargaming on track.
Ow!
And now, what's in the news? With the shout-out, the gaming geek, the source for all your miniature board game and role-play game needs at some of the most competitive prices on eBay. Hey, hey, hey. Currently stocking Dystopian Wars, Warhammer 40,000, and Malifaux, along with many other popular RPGs and board games. Find them at stores.ebay.com/the-gaming-geek. Check it out. Well, now the news. Well, it looks like dungeon crawl games are the new hotness this year for manufacturers. Every company's got to have one. Recently, Mantic announced they'd have one coming out in the not-too-distant future. We just heard reports from PAX on the Super Dungeon Explorer. And now we have a new announcement from Plaid Hat Games. You know, the folks that brought you that cool little card-based combat game known as Summoner Wars. Folks at Plaid Hat are producing a new dungeon crawler called Dungeon Run. And the basic premise appears to be that you fight your way into the dungeon cooperatively. You then slay the evil beastie at the end, only to find that your fellow adventurers have now turned against you and you must fight each other in the grand finale and on the way out. Or something like that. Sounds like a cross between Ravenloft and Cutthroat Caverns. Interesting. In geek movie news, we have some interesting, exciting news about The Hobbit. Some casting information has shown up on IMDb, you know, the big internet movie database that everybody goes to when they need to look up a quote. In any case, they've got some rumored, kind of exciting casting going on in the episode. First of all, you've got a Vulcan. Leonard Nimoy is being rumored to be cast as Smaug. No idea if it's true, but it's a mighty cool rumor. Then we have David Tennant, that's right, what some would argue the coolest doctor in recent memory, will be playing Thranduil. And Aidan Turner will be cast as Killy. And many of you may know Aidan as that vampire guy from the British series Being Human. So you got a vampire, a Vulcan, and the doctor on this. Quite a cast there. Yeah, and it's going to be awesome, despite what my wife says about hobbits not being as cool as Ewoks. What's that, Weakland? I got to follow on Twitter. It's a crazy argument, but I'm here to tell you, hobbits beat Ewoks. All right. Thank you, Weakland. Anyway, moving right along. In other news, I'm not sure what happened there. In other news, a new expansion announced by Fantasy Flight Games for Chaos in the Old World. You may remember that Chaos in the Old World is that four-player game where each player assumes the role of one of the Warhammer Fantasy gods, Khorne and Nurgle and all those guys. Well, this new expansion is going to add a fifth player. Guess who? The Horned Rat. Yes, I hear many of you Warhammer players right there going, oh, I got to buy that. Yes, you do. Fantasy Flight Games, of course, not to be outdone with only one expansion. They need to make two. This other big expansion announced was for Twilight Imperium. Twilight Imperium, Shards of the Throne. Because Twilight Imperium just doesn't have enough bits yet. Although, I have to admit, some of the plastic in this new expansion are pretty cool looking. First of all, you got three new races, and each civilization gets a new flagship. Ooh, cool looking models. And then also they get mechanized units for ground force support as well. And there's another interesting concept. Oh, yeah, it's an innovative mechanic. Easy, Wakeland. Promissory notes, which require binding promises during the game, that can be called in at any time. Interesting. That's kind of fascinating. No word yet on what the actual game length is now. In miniature war game news, the latest issue of No Quarter has the full rules for Privateer Press's Battle Engines coming out in War Machine to be featured in the book Wrath. So as Privateer Press's want to do, the No Quarter has all the Battle Engine rules, as well as the full stats and fluff around the Cador Battle Engine as well. So if you're interested in how the Battle Engine is going to work, check that out. This may hint that some Battle Engine models may be available before the Wrath book hits the streets. Time will tell. In other news, WizKids has just released a rulebook update for HeroClix. That's right, if you're a HeroClix fan and want to see the latest rules, head on over to WizKids' website to check that out. Catalyst Games, who've been working quite some time now on the miniature war game they've been previewing called Leviathan have finally released some preview photos of actual test casts of their Leviathan models. Go on over to monstersinthesky.com, all one word, and you can check out some test models. They look pretty good, actually. Let's check that out. And finally, in video game news, Mass Effect 2 DLC, the final bit of downloadable content for Mass Effect 2, has just hit the various networks. It's called Arrival, and it came out this week. Early reviews are not great. Apparently, it's not the best downloadable content they've ever done for Mass Effect 2. I'm going to get it anyway, though, baby. It's going to have us play in Mass Effect 3. I got to see it. Seriously, you're going to buy it just because you... How can you not? It's Mass Effect. All right, well, anyway, I guess if you're a total Mass Effect fanboy like Wakeland, you have to buy it. But if you're not, you may want to think twice or check it with your friend first before you pick this one up. And that's What's in the News.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. Born to game.
And lest we forget, Battle Foam, protecting your army so you don't have to.
Hoorah!
Hoorah!
Wow, I like that, Craig.
Well, you
I felt like I was playing Dragon Age or something.
I've been working on it for a while.
Right.
The number one place to get your custom foam trays, and you can go to his new website.
Have you been there yet?
Awesome.
Oh, it's fantastic, dude.
Awesome.
Is it really?
It is so cool. Craig, go look at it right now while I tell our listeners.
All right. I'm kind of thinking okay, cool website, but whatever.
No, you got to check it out. It's like bullet shells all over the place, and it's much easier to navigate.
Much easier to navigate.
There's a really cool gallery now to check everything out. They got a new retail store locator, so you can go on there and figure out where the local closest store is that carries Battle Foam, and there's a retailer sign up too. So if you're a store that does carry Battle Foam or want to, go there, get signed up so you make sure you're on Romeo's website.
Oh, yeah, it is way easier to navigate.
Oh, it's very, very cool. And right there on the front page, you can see he is doing some mad, mad partnership deals, people.
You know it.
If you're right down the side, it's like game company logo, game company logo, game company logo, game. It's like Privateer Press, Malifaux, Spartan Games, Heavy Gear, Mantic, you name it. Anybody hot in the miniature game space, except for one exception, is on there as a partner making some of the... They're making sure their miniature games come in the best possible bags on the planet.
Yep.
And they look fantastic. So I can't wait to see what the logos and everything look like on some of the newer guys.
There's only one problem. He's got a 40K radio blurb instead of D6G needs to be bigger.
Well,
he
does own 40K radio.
Because he does own 40K radio.
Yeah, I know. Right. But,
and I say own. He salvaged 40K radio from the ashes.
Right? Yes, he did.
So he didn't want it to die for the community.
That's all it was, really. Yeah. It's not making him any money. He just does it for the love of the hobby. And we should know about podcasts not making money.
Yeah.
And a funny story, this is hilarious. So just to show you the level of company that Battle Foam is, I'm at PAX East this past weekend, and Geek Chic is there. You know, the guys that make the fantastic, I mean, heirloom quality furniture, right? And I open, they have the coffee table, and you open it up, and there's all your game controllers for your Wii and your Xbox and your PS3, all of this beautiful foam that fits exactly into the drawers. And I'm looking at that going, that looks a lot like Romeo's work. And the guy working there goes, you know Romeo? Yeah, that's Battle Foam. They don't get any better than that. I'm like, bam! There's two best companies on the planet working together making some great products. So that's Romeo working it, making sure that his foam is everywhere and making sure that these quality tables have great foam in them, even in your table.
That's awesome.
So that was hilarious.
And, of course, one of the things that we're excited about is the new partnership with Spartan Games.
That's right. That's right. It's one of the big partners there. I can't wait to see there. And they're redesigning the foam, the tray designer to make it easier because there's so many different things to choose from. They're going to make it easier to organize all the different shapes you can put in your trays.
Huh.
And the big thing, of course, guys, you're going to be seeing Battle Foam at Adepticon.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, they're going to be there. They're big Adepticon fans. And so you're going to see Romeo and the crew there.
Unfortunately, we can't hang out with Romeo because his mommy and daddy live there in Chicago. And he keeps leaving as soon as the shop closes.
Oh, Romeo.
Yeah, plus he's just straight out. He told me we might not see much of him, you know.
Well, maybe you can chill out.
You can go and hang out at the booth. He's always willing to chat. But I think that's the first thing he ever went to that he sold out completely.
Right, right. So his heart is well placed at Adepticon. So.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ooh, you could have your top cover tray be custom logo.
You always could.
Always could.
Well, now it's much clearer on the website.
They're called toppers. See, look, the new website's already working. So check out your own topper and make sure it's ready for Adepticon.
At battlefoam.com.
No one could have believed, in the first years of the 21st century, that gaming podcasts would spread across the planet like a strange red Martian weed. Striding among them, like a huge alien tripod, walked the D6 generation. The astronomer Ogilvy assured me that the chances of anything good coming out of New Hampshire were 1,000,000 to 1. But still, they came. The D6 generation, the greatest gaming podcast on this or any other planet, and the only one to feature words from Wales. And I looked up, straight into the eyes of my beloved Carrie.
And now, what 35 of you have all been waiting for.
Woohoo! But the rest of you, you know, the rest of you don't even know you're waiting for this.
See what I did there?
Because this is fantastic. The entries we got for this contest, can I just say, are awesome.
They are far, fantastic. Far better than less than horrible. Not
yes.
So horrible.
Now there is, though, so before we get into that, though, Craig, could you describe the contest for those who just joined us?
Yes, the contest was we wanted you to tell us if you were fleeing Atlantis,
yes,
and you could only bring 3 games with you on the little rowboat to escape,
right,
what would those games be?
Right. And what was the prize, Rafe?
I have no idea. That was like 100 years ago.
Jeez.
Okay.
All right, Craig, what was the prize?
The prize was a copy of the awesome Stronghold Games game, Survive,
right,
Escaping Atlantis.
No, that was easy, Trevor.
Escape from Atlantis.
And we threw in code 777. And we threw in the Squeeples.
That's right, which you can't get right now, by the way.
Squeeples. Yeah, actually, these are the Squid Meeples that are an additional expansion for Survive. And they are awesome, and they're hard to find, apparently.
Oh, yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah, they're kind of getting hard to find. So that's the deal. Now, what's interesting about these entries, and I want everybody to listen for this as we go. Now, the three of us have listened to most of the entries, but not all together yet. And we've not picked our, so we're really live on the air right now. While we listen along with you, we're going to make some comments as we go, and we're going to record our favorites. At the end, we're going to each present our 3 favorites,
yep,
and wherever there's overlap, if there's one overlap, that's the winner. Otherwise, we'll figure out some kind of randomizing way from our favorites, right?
Probably we'll use a D6.
Probably, but not necessarily, depending on what's at hand.
Now, that's true.
Also, I noticed one little common theme here, which I kind of found disturbing in most of these.
So I
kind of want to see if the rest of you, our listeners, can sort of listen for a theme to all these entries. See if you can notice it. Craig, I already know what I'm talking about.
I already know.
All right, so here we go. So here is our very first entry. And these are in no particular order. They're not even in the order they were submitted, really, to be honest. This is the first we're going to listen to.
And there's a whole bunch that are read by me that if you sent in an email. So.
Right, right. Here we go. Any moment. It's coming now.
Hey, guys. This is Travis Winter calling in for the Survive contest on top of episode 73, I believe. I'm an episode behind. This is the single worst thing you could have done to any true gamer out there. Whittled their collection down to 3 games. My God, I have thought nothing of other than this all day long, and I started listening to this podcast at 5 o'clock in the morning.
Whoa.
It is now 12:42 as I'm going home from my second job.
We filled your day.
The first thing I have to think of is games that will fit multiple niches. Dominion has to be the first one on my list. I grab Dominion because it's a fun game. My family enjoys playing it. And it takes care of that collectible card game itch. So that obviously has to be one of the games that goes. My second one, I choose Blood Bowl. Because it's going to take care of my miniature gaming niche, as well as it's just a very fun board game. And I think the best game Games Workshop has ever created. It's easy to learn, hard to master. If we get stuck on an island and when we've left Atlantis, I can create models. I'm not even worried about that. As long as I have the rules and the board, I can build anything to make them look like the teams.
Sound reasoning.
The third one. Oh, my God. I have no idea. Do I get something for my family, or do I go truly selfish and grab something that I really, really love? Oh, my. I don't even know what to say for the third one. So I guess I go with my family. I have to make sure that they're happy we escaped Atlantis. By God, I better do something for them. So I think we go with Ticket to Ride. My son loves playing it. My wife enjoys playing it. And I have tons of friends who enjoy playing it. And I've got a lot of fun memories of the game. So those are my three. Dominion, Blood Bowl by Games Workshop, and Ticket to Ride. Thanks, guys. Yeah. Bye.
Those are solid choices.
Really sound thinking in there.
There
like
was
it.
Some really good rationalization in there.
Yes,
He sort of used my thinking of like there's categories I need to fill,
right?
which I appreciated. So that was pretty good.
Yeah, I like how the family it was on the edge there for a while.
Yeah, listen for this theme. Listen for this theme about the family.
Keep listening.
It's my hint. Here we go. Let's see who's next on the hit parade here.
Hey guys, my name's Joe, and I'm entering the Survive contest. And the three games that I would take with me, I kind of have a qualification here, two lists. Just one is, if my wife is actually going to make it off the island, I'm going to have to go with games I know she'll like. So we're going to go with Flux, because she enjoys that, mostly because our kids can play it. Settlers of Catan, just because it's Settlers. Who doesn't like that game? And I know there are people that don't, but most people do. And Carcassonne, because she's in love with meeples, and I like Carcassonne as well. But on the assumption that she doesn't make it off the island, I'm going to go with Small World, Formula Day, and Railroad Tycoon. Because they fill that nice period of time. Small World's short but fun. Railroad Tycoon, very long but very good. And Formula Day, because up to 10 players, how can't you love that? Thanks a lot, guys. Hopefully I get somewhere with this.
All right.
I like how they're going to probably fill that time of mourning because he lost his wife.
Railroad Tycoon will fill that. It's very long.
I was going to say, Rage, you must like that call. He had to pick the railroad game for you there.
Yeah, I got to check out Railroad Tycoon now.
Yeah. So I thought that was so. Listen for that theme. See if you're hearing it yet. Here we go.
Yeah.
Let's see who's next here.
This is Ben Mitchell in Iowa. I'm just calling for the Survive contest. If I was fleeing Atlantis, the three games that I would take with me. Number one, I take a 52-card deck, A, because I like poker, but also because it's sort of the Swiss coming knife of gaming. There's an endless amount of games you can play with a deck of cards. Plus, if you get in an unsavory situation and you got to draw for it, you're all set up. The second game I would pick is Battle of Westeros. Number one, it's a great game. Number two, since I assume in this little scenario I'd be out to sea for a long amount of time or maybe even wash up on a deserted island, my hope would be that by the time I get rescued, that guy would finally be done with the next book, and I could read it, so I wouldn't be missing out on it.
Wow.
My third choice would be the miniature game Malifaux.
Ooh, nice.
And I get two reasons for taking Malifaux. Number one, it's a great game that doesn't require a lot of room, so as long as we're on the boat, we can play it all the way till we get to our deserted island. The second reason, and this is my ace in the hole, is it seems like since I would be lost at sea or lost on a deserted island, anytime I sit down to play a miniature game, my wife it seems to be able to find me or get a hold of me within 45 minutes to 60 minutes. So as long as I'm playing a miniature game, I know that the rescue boat will be coming because my wife would be looking for me. All right, guys, have a great day. Enjoy the show, and see ya.
Love it.
I'm sensing a segment here.
I was going to say, another person who didn't quite make it off with his wife. I don't understand.
How to deal with the wife.
Yeah, but his wife is out there somewhere.
No, I did like the positive spin where he knew she was coming for him.
His wife's calling him on a coconut phone,
right?
No,
I mean,
where he is.
It's actually kind of a happy thought. He's thinking, if I play a miniature game, it means she's going to find me.
Exactly.
Because that's how the universe works. So that was kind of a very, very thoughtful, loving thing.
I liked that.
I liked that one, too. All right. Who's up next? Let's see. Good music.
My fellow Atlanteans of my arbitrarily selected color faction, I, Spookius, greet you. As you know, due to recent circumstances, to include Phaegon crystals reaching $100 a crate, military setbacks and our ongoing wars of domination against Mu and Lemuria, and foolishly bringing upon us the wrath of the gods, incidentally, it was an extremely poor choice to hold the weekly drunken revelries at the Temple of Zoltar, god of quiet contemplation, overreaction, and continental instability. Anyway, the practical upshot of which is that our mighty island or continent, depending on your source material, is in fact crumbling in the metaphorical sense.
I think it's crumbling.
And literally. We all know that due to the timeless glories of our civilization, we shall always be remembered for many things. For example, our mighty structures, the Great Road near Bimini, for example, will never be mistaken for a natural formation. Our legends, such as the timeless tale of Vorlach and the 37 stepbrothers with time with stone beards, will delight readers for countless generations, and our very land here, clearly placed beyond the pillars of that hero guy who visited us the other day, will be easy to pinpoint.
Uh-oh.
Anyway, therefore, it is time for us to leave our island and spread across the globe. Now, we all know that the technologies that are the core of our civilization, such as the singing levitation stones, the ether gate pyramids, and the antimicrobial crystal beams allowing the cure for the curing of all diseases, are so basic that even the spear-chucking simpletons that walk the rest of this world will invent them in the next 100 years or so. Instead, we will bring our board games to act as our legacy. No, although card games would be easier to carry, we're bringing more games. Well, who are you going to trade with if you only bring one deck? Anyway. What? No, Atlantean Hammer 40,000 is a tabletop game. You'll never fit all the factions one, but... Yes, I've made up my mind. Anyway. Now, since I am worth 3 points, I will take the games in my rowboat. You there. You're only worth 1 point. Take this copy of Atlantean Axis and Allies and swim for the yonder islands. Yes, very good. Keep paddling. Keep the strokes up. Hey, watch out for that. Oh, never mind. Well, at least that game will never curse the world again. Anyway, for the record, we will row away from the sea serpent-infested waters over there. Now, for the rest of you three-pointers in my boat, first, we shall bring Atlantis Lego Creationary. This is a fine game to while away with the children we will have with the sub-races of this world, and we will use it to explain our fantastical devices to ensure that our mighty island or continent state is never mistaken for something some hack philosopher pulls out of his toga to make a point about society. Second, we shall show them the horrors that befell the kingdom of Candelandia before its collapse in our terrible but delicious invasion by bringing Run for Your Life, Atlantean Candyman. Yes, we will teach the locals how to bake bread so they can make their own Candyman. You think bread-making technology is just going to spring up spontaneously all over the world on its own? Finally, although it is a flash in the crystal wave oven, we shall take this Atlantean chess game we came up with the other game. What is that? No, it's not too complex. Players will always know that the horse-headed gods of Volox and Zulov only walk in an L-shaped direction. Yes, they will remember that Zomat, the crippled king, could only move one place at a time, while his queen, Sava, the levitating, could move all over the place. Well, very well, it's time to go. Wish the rest of you best of luck and hope to see you all drier and drier and more stable land. In the meantime, stroke! Stroke! Stoke, watch out for that whale!
Wow.
Wow, that's quite the entry there, Spooky. I think Craig may have lost a lung on that one.
I'd rather like be in a reenactment with him.
No kidding, man.
Wow. Spooky.
Oh, God, I think I busted something.
So that was great. He referenced game mechanics in there with the whole points for the meeples thing.
Oh, yeah.
Awesome. I can't think of a single button he didn't push.
Right.
He's like, you're only worth 1 point.
Right. Distract him. Wow, go ahead, Spooky. That was a good one. So let's see who the next one is here.
Hi, guys. This is Paul from D.C. I love the show. I've been listening for the last few months, trying to catch up on all the old shows, and I'm almost there. I guess if I had to bring 3 games with me when fleeing a sinking island, I would want some that ensure I had the best crowd possible in the boat to play them with. I would be sure to bring Agricola, since as soon as I pulled it out, all the angry, bitter, cynical refugees would immediately jump out and show themselves to the sea monsters rather than play. I would have to bring something flashy and cool that was popular a while back that I could chuck into another boat. That way, any annoying magpies would follow it, hop out of my boat into theirs, and drink all the soda over there. Finally, I would have to bring something long-term and confusing like Twilight Imperium, so that any easily distracted refugees would just kind of wander off and leave me in my nice open boat with all the pizza safe and sound. Ideally, then, I should be left with a boat full of supplies, no annoying gamers, and maybe some honeys saying, hey, what's up with the dice? Thanks for a great show, guys. Keep it up. Bye.
Honey, he's left for the dice. Nice. So that was a good one.
See, that was, I think that was pro Agricola, Rafe.
It was pro Agricola, yes.
Yeah.
It was so kind of interesting. Not, yeah, he was Disney.
Yeah.
Yep.
I like it.
I like how he used the games to distract himself to get the optimum boat. That was very clever.
Exactly. The one with all the pizza.
Right, and the honeys. All right. Let's see who's next here.
What are you doing?
Well, I'm trying to decide what to bring. I mean, we got to get the heck out of here, right? So I need to pack my bags.
Yeah, I can see that. I've already packed my bags, and I didn't include any board games.
Well, that's why I'm including them.
This is a life and death thing?
Yes, I know. It's life or death. That's what I'm trying. I'm only bringing three. Only what will fit in this one bag.
Okay, will they float? Because, you know, we might need things to help keep us afloat.
Oh, I'm keeping these close to my body, so they'll be fine. No, seriously, what do you think? Should I bring Le Havre or Shadows Over Camelot?
Well, you know, it really depends who's in our lifeboat with us.
Well, which one did you reserve? If it's A, we're with the Jensens, or we're not with your mother, are we?
No. Okay, no, thank goodness. Yeah, she wouldn't understand the rules.
Try and get the lifeboat with the Wongs. They're really good, and I think one of them is bringing Yomi along.
Ooh. You know, the Wongs, they kind of like the longer games, so maybe Le Havre would be good.
All right.
Yeah.
Putting in Le Havre, and
especially if it's a long ride from here to Antarctica.
Yeah. And where? We're not going to Antarctica. I thought we were in the middle of the Mediterranean.
Atlantis.
Okay,
hello.
Let's not have this fight again, all right? Mediterranean, everybody knows it.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay, the poles
are
not... Poles are not shifting. It's a volcano.
Anyway.
All right, so I have Le Havre, I'm thinking Small World, and I need something else that's Jones Theory compliant.
What?
Never mind. I need something that isn't the same as those two.
Well, what about Dixit?
Dixit would work. I mean, I'll assume that your parents survive, so that's something they can play with.
That's true. We kind of hope that they survive, but you know.
Well, some of us do. Yeah. So, Dixit, Small World, and Le Havre.
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, I'm set to go.
Do we have any food?
What about the kids?
Ooh.
Wow, that was a good one, too.
I like that one.
Oh, man, I'm in pain.
You guys out there are fantastic.
That was awesome.
That was really good.
I love how folks are not only getting in the game mechanics, but then they're bringing in Atlantis lore also. Antarctica, what? We got this already again? That was great. That was fantastic. Okay, who's up next? Again, the theme, though, with certain family members not making
that's
it.
True.
I'm just saying there's a subtle theme here where people
did
are like,
we do that? Did we
no,
say
no,
something?
No, but people are using this to prune their family tree, people. What's going on here? All right, let's keep going. What's up next?
I don't know.
It's going to be a surprise.
Hey, wake up.
Hey, D6G crew. I'm calling to enter your contest, and I've actually one-upped you guys. I've got my boat all set up, got my games picked out. So the three games I picked Heroescape. I have tons of figures, tons of terrain. I'll be able to mix up battles, play as many different variations of that. Is that... That's a volcano. Ah! Oh, my Heroescape. Oh. All right, well, I still have my other two games. All right, here, we're going to get out of here. Come on. Honey, we got to get the boat. Let's go. I've got my Go board here. Simple Abstract. I've learned a little bit how to play, but I'll finally master this game.
Hey, he's got a boat. Got him.
No, get out of here. Oh, well, I've got my last game. Still have my last game. Dominion. It's a lot of fun. Plays quick. But the best part of all is I'll be able to mix up millions of combinations with just the cards I have here in the base. Oh.
That's how it ends?
Yes.
Oh, it's like a cliffhanger.
I don't know.
Poor guy didn't make it off with a single game.
I like how it was kind of implied that he clubbed the dude with his go board. That was fantastic.
Look. Up their boat.
That was a good one too. You know, sometimes short is beautiful. I got to say that was pretty elegantly.
Yeah, I like how there's no explanation. It's just
that's right.
Just left a wonder.
Oh, bleep! Right, exactly. I guess the moral we might also be learning here. He did mention his wife coming, which is good. But I think the moral here is that maybe you know bringing games along the middle of a natural disaster is not the right choice. Let's keep going here until we get next.
Quickly, the island is sinking. Atlantean,
What is that?
What, these?
Yes, those boxes. They're my board games. This is no time for games. Leave them here.
No, they're more than just games. Take Descent, for example. It could come in really handy if we run into sharks.
Sharks! Quickly, hit them with Descent. Well, what about that one?
That's Small World. It's an amazing game, but also, the tray is carefully designed to hold all the pieces. Perfect for travel on the high seas.
Praise be to Days of Wonder. A lesser game would be made unplayable by these high seas.
And that one? Carcassonne. Not only is it a simple, clever tile-laying game that brings new challenges with every turn, the cardboard tiles are a great source of fibre, or can be used to spell out messages when stranded on an island. And when the tiles are all gone, a few minutes of doodling can transform the scoreboard into an infinite game of snakes and ladders. So, can I bring them?
Tell you what, you wait here and I'll send another boat back for you.
Well, I suppose I can always use Descent as a raft and Carcassonne as a paddle, but what will I do with Small World?
Oh, I knew I should have bought Flux. It's so much more economical.
Small World is not intended to be used in a high seas environment. Customers playing Small World on the high seas do so at their own risk.
This is going to be a tough decision, people.
I don't know, man. Oh, my God.
When we were listening to these, I was like, which one are we not going to play? I think we had to play all of them because they're so fantastic.
Yeah.
All right. Let's see. Who's up next? Let's see.
Jeez.
That was a good one.
Honey, I'm home from a hard day at work at the law firm Granger and Stoney.
Did you win another case today with your strategy? It's Atlantis. No lawsuits.
Yep. Another case thrown out.
What was that noise?
By Poseidon, Atlantis is sinking.
We gotta get the kids.
And three board games.
What are you talking about, you idiot?
Well, I gotta have my space help card game.
Daddy, what's going on?
Three plus for merchants and marauders. Okay, I will take that.
Cool. Grab some more for survival.
Has anyone seen my eye touch?
Last game will be Descent. Never played that, but always wanted to. I can't believe I've had all these games in my library all this time. Okay, I'm ready.
Grab the kids!
Can't, my hands are full of board games.
So the sound effects are just incredible.
There's another family member left behind. More tree pruning. I'm telling you.
Oh, that's hilarious.
How'd you like the law firm there, Rafe?
I'm writing it down.
I'm writing it down.
Trademark it.
That was awesome.
I don't know, man.
See who's next.
Making it harder and harder.
It is. Tough decisions here, people. You make it hard.
Okay. Here we are in beautiful Atlantis. Oh, wait.
That's a Titanic.
Why do we hear that music? Unless is to prelude to something terrible that is going to happen? Oh no! Disaster! This place is sinking! Quick! We have to go! Hey, don't you think we could bring something? Yes, yes! But what? I have my iPod, but I will get bored eventually after listening to that many D6G episodes. Right, the games! We have to save the games! Pass them to me, quick! Here you go. What? Magic the Gathering? You have to be kidding me. Okay, okay. War Machine? Those cases are too heavy, and we do not have enough space in the robot to play that. At least, leave the cases. I hope Battle Foam floats. Okay. Scrabble, my wife is not here. Okay. Through the Ages, that is a good game, small, with good strategic level, and we will have valuable civilizations information if we need to rebuild any of them after this. Small World, that game is fun, not too difficult, with high replay value, and we may be able to play that with the sea people we meet. Pandemic, we will need to learn how to work together, and that is a good cooperative game. We have them. Go, go, go! Okay, we are safe. Let's eat.
Eat?
What? Oh no, I knew I should have brought a Agricola. It has veggies, cereals, cattle.
Yeah, but you can never tell which color is which anyway.
Oh, shut up.
Wow.
Oh, jeez.
Holy crap, man.
Okay.
Oh, this just isn't fair.
Is it too good? You know, when we were smaller, we'd get like three entries and only one was really great. Now there's like all these fantastic entries. Oh, man.
Oh, man.
All right. So here we go. Great stuff, guys. This is hilarious. Hope everybody's enjoying this as much as we are. So next one up is, let's see who's next here. A little bit of seawater still. Yeah, you get that with Atlantis.
I mean, people can't see me, but I'm like grinning.
We're ready to set off. So what games did you save then, lad? I've brought Twilight Imperium, sir. Good thinking. Those pesky whales tip us over. We'll be able to use the lid as a lifeboat. Yes, sir. But that really isn't why I bought it. The game is a sort of space-time paradox. It somehow slows down the flow of time. I believe with carefully applied research, we may learn exactly how this is achieved, and then we'll be able to travel back in time and prevent Atlantis from sinking in the first place. Excellent idea. I've also got a copy of this game called Evo. I know you hate, I mean, you're very disappointed with Euro games, but it's got dinosaurs in it, sir, and everyone knows dinosaurs are cool. I see. And what are those other two boxes you have? Well, it's a copy of Ninja vs. Ninja, and that new Merchants and Marauders game, but I believe we only have space for one of them. Then chuck that ninja rubbish over the side. Everyone knows that pirates are better than ninjas. Why is that, sir? Because they are. Now, while you've got the games, I found this mighty stick. I hope to be able to fashion an extra mast. The added speed should help us outrun any sharks that we encounter during our escape. Sorry to correct you, sir. It's not really a stick. Technically, it's a pole. And it's not what I'd call mighty, either. It looks pretty flimsy to me. In fact, sir, due to the nature of the pole, I'd say it'll barely hold 250 pounds. That said, sir, I do have an idea of what we could use it for.
An oldie but a goodie.
Wow, that joke just does not die.
Oh, that one hurt again.
Oh, man. Oh, wow, God. That's fantastic. You guys are awesome. Okay, so who's up next? Let's see.
Hi, guys. This is Stefan Rothschuh calling from Germany, and this is my entry for the Survive contest.
Hey, Stefan.
It was inspired by an Irish folk song variously known as The Sick Note, The Bricklayer's Song, or Why Paddy's Not at Work Today. You can check it out on YouTube or the like. It's actually quite funny. Ooh. Anyway, so here goes. Dear D6G, I write to you to tell you of the three games that I would take from the sinking island and with me bring safely to the other shore, so I need never fear to be without the gaming fun that I hold so dear. Now, first and foremost, I would save a dungeon-crawling game. This genre early on in youth my heart and soul did claim. Of all the game experiences truly are the best. Those tales of heroes brave and bold pursuing a deadly quest. The first game I would take, therefore, is Wonderful Descent, the loss of which I surely would most grievously lament. This dungeon-crawling beauty is the pinnacle of fun. I'd haul its coffin anywhere, though it weighs a metric ton. While first among the fancies of the geek is fantasy, the second passion definitely is technology. So lasers and conveyor belts must be part of the mix of titles from which I would henceforth get my gaming fix. Thus Robo-Rally I would also rescue from the aisle. I love it for its wackiness and chaotic style. 8 robots armed and dangerous sure look a deadly horde. Yet more oft than not you'll see them go careening off the board. Now sailing from Atlantis I could end up anywhere. So at least one game I'd rescue that is lighter fare. Because to many folks our hobby is entirely new. Not everyone's a gamer geek, it's sad, I know, but true. So Pitch Car is the third game that I take, there's no debate. It brings light-hearted flicking fun and plays up to 8. Its zooming cars and ease of play will bring into the fold of our beloved gaming culture, people young and old. With these 3 games I'd brave the seas around Atlantis shore, all teeming with enormous squids, blue whales, black sharks, and more. And if on the horizon a sea monster should appear, I'll spend a movement point and jump, praying a dolphin's near.
That was unbelievable.
Wow. That was fantastic. Wow. And we should, listeners, we're recording this on St. Patrick's Day.
On St. Patrick's Day.
So that was doubly appropriate. Wow.
And it was like a cappella and in tune.
I know. That was fantastic.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
That was awesome.
That took a long time to write.
That did. Craig, and get down.
You know what I was picturing is, could you imagine if, like, at your bachelor party that where we were at an Irish pub that was really sung? We've got to have that really sung in an Irish pub now.
That was awesome.
With music.
We should play it at Paddy Con as the official Paddy Con theme song.
Ooh, yes.
We have the original. Uh-oh. Thank you so much.
I think, there we go. Well, will be played at Paddy Con.
There you go.
In McNerdigan's pub.
So it's won at least a consolation prize. We'll have to listen further to see if it wins the grand prize. Let's see.
That's right.
Who's up next? Every time I hear one, I think it can't get any better than this. And it does.
I've been trying to keep it to 3 top 3 as we go, and I've already got top 8.
So I've got 5.
I know, right? Here we go. Who's next? Let's see. You guys are amazing.
That was hard work escaping from Atlantis, which, judging by my accent, sounds a lot like New Zealand. So let's see what essential supplies we have here. The scent. It's a great dungeon crawler, and the box doubles as a spare lifeboat. What else? Two pesky seagulls. Okay, let's have a look. Ah, here we go. Carcassonne. The Council of Elders seems to love this one. They take to it very well. And my wife likes it too. This last one was a difficult choice. I might have to phrase it like Russ, who, being Atlantean, I know almost nothing of. But let's say I was fleeing Atlantis with a group of new gamers, I would be taking Small World. But if I was fleeing Atlantis with a group of, let's say, more cerebral gamers, I would be taking Agricola.
Is that it?
I think so. Let's see.
Okay, so here are...
Oh, yep, here comes a new one. So next up is Craig reading some text entries. Here we go. Ready? Here we go. Craig. Here we go. Ready, Craig?
Ready.
All right, here we go.
Here are the entries for those people who could not be bothered to make their own...
Wow.
were unable for one reason or another to make their own audio selections. First from Greg Pendergrast, the 3 games I would like in a boat are The War of the Ring, Collector's Edition, Big League Hockey Manager, that one sounds fun right there, right up your alley, Rafe, and Carcassonne. So not a lot of editorial comment there, just a fine list. George Molinari.
Stop.
We got to pause between each one? Okay, what do you got?
Well, I just want to pause so that you know that I'm literally reading exactly. None of those are my editorial comments.
No, right. These are just straight up.
I just want you to know.
Oh,
okay.
All right.
That's not me saying, oh, Rafe, you would like, I'm reading exactly what was sent to us.
Right. Okay. All right. Here we go. Number 2.
Only a single game on a lifeboat because there was some confusion when we said 1 game or 3 games. So that's why there. He would take Earth Reborn. Then he would whack each of us over the head with it for not giving it a passing mention on the show.
Oh, God.
And he says, seriously, you guys love tabletop games and role-playing games, regardless of whether you find the time to play them. If you guys don't love this board game, and I mean love, not like, I will play Magic the Gathering and send you a YouTube video of me doing it. Skim through the rules, and I'm sure you will respect the granddaddy of Ameritrash games.
I have to pause it there. Because I did give Earth Reborn a try.
I was thinking that that's
and
the one you would
we
try.
Could not get past it. So I expect to see a YouTube video of you playing Magic.
There you go.
Yeah, we thought the setup time was just too heavy for what it was, and the payout was too low. But I couldn't give it any more than that. Sorry, guys. All right, keep going. Let's keep going.
Okay.
So there you go. I think Russ, haven't you played it? I don't.
Yes.
Know. Oh, and a fun fact that George included was the Earth Reborn box has Space Hulk heft, and he's not kidding about wanting to whack us each over the head with it. Brian Siebert had an epic fail on his new superphone, so he sent an entire script, which I will do the best, to do honor to. Thunder rumbles. Nice. And then there's going to be sheen. I am making this recording so that some of my voice will go with you, my son. Kablammo! Our home island is sinking and there's not room for all of us to go. So I am sending you and your mother with some analog training simulations. Kaboom! First, I am sending you with a rebuilding simulator called Settlers of Catan. This is so you know the correct ratio of wheat and stone to build a city. Crash! Bang! Next is a simulation to prepare you for the inevitable zombie uprising. Zombies! I know you will fight the undead with all of your strength. Last is a simulator to know how to deal with the great old ones. They are crafty devils. It is known as Arkham Horror. Scree! Oh, God! Smash! Bang! Scree! Oh, God! Another giant squid! Go! I will fight it off! Scree! Oh, God! Not the tentacles again! The end. Kristen Frere Jorgensen. I definitely bring the Civilization board game. Almost all of it is edible. I don't know what version she's using. And you know what they say, the more edible things around you, the less edible you look. However, this rule, she says, does not apply when children are around. Those things will eat you anyway. Joe Flash says, my list is conditional. If my wife survives the island's destruction, I'm going to have to take games to satisfy her and the kids. So we'll go with Flux because the kids like it, Settlers because everyone else likes it, and Carcassonne because my wife is obsessed with meeples. I know how that is.
I think this guy phoned in his own and wrote us a note.
Yeah, because that one might be in there already. But that gets back to the whole theme where, you know, there's a lot of discussion about whether or not wives make it on this.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of interesting.
If she does not survive the island, I'll go with Railroad Tycoon because it's a great deep economic game and took me like a year to get a copy. Formula D because it's 10-player sport and there aren't any games that take that many players. And finally, Small World because it's just damn fun. Danny Scarf says, as I run to my boat to survive the end of my beloved Atlantis, I must pause to gather some things I cannot live without. No, not my family. They'd only slow me down. But three games that are a must in any situation. One, Catan, Seafarer's Edition, of course, for added survival chances. Two, Talisman, honing my skills for ensuring my way to the top. And three, Carcassonne, to practice building for when we reach our destination. Let's just hope the others who made it to the boat also like the games.
Wow.
Jason Mitchell says, well, if I had to fit the games in a rowboat along with my fiancé, two dogs, and a cat, I would choose the following. The first one is Arkham Horror. You have to have the Let's Save the World type game, and I love the theme. The second would be Dominion. The fiancé and I really enjoy this quick card game. And finally would be Sid Meier's Civilization. The fiancé actually, I know, I love how she doesn't get a name. She's the fiancé. It's kind of like a movie. She actually enjoyed this one, and our podcast helped to convince her to try it.
Hey.
Next would be Neil Derman. The way I see it, you really have to take a long-term view on this one. For this reason, I'm thinking ahead a bit. I am mean sure we have escaped the island in our little boat, and we brought some board games along, so at least we won't get bored. You see what he did there? Mm-hmm. So now what? I mean, we didn't bring much food, and we don't know when we'll be rescued. For this reason, I reckon you need to have a series of games with you for various numbers of players. Initially, you want a game with quite a lot of people can play, and
oh, no.
which can be played by various numbers of players. I'm thinking Small World with all the expansions. Five players and a lot of replayability that should last a while, but eventually people are going to start dying off, being eaten by the rest of us, so we can survive. And Small World will get boring eventually. Besides, all that raw human flesh is getting a bit much, and the thick card and tokens in Small World are starting to look kind of tasty. At this point, you want a game geared more for two players. I mean, the last two people left have bonded over the killing and eating of friends and family at this point, so you should know each other pretty well. I'm thinking Battles of Westeros. Again, replayability should keep you going for a while. In the end, if you're out there for a long time, your survival strategy is going to have to come down to some solo time, or you may just get angry after losing a game of Westeros and overreact a little. You've been in a boat for a long time now. At this point, you want something fun, which you can play alone. I'm thinking I'd do with Arkham Horror, because at this point, I'm sure I'd be insane already, so I may as well go with the theme. Dan May.
Hey, Dan.
Says, three games for a desert island. One, Twilight Imperium, so he could use the box as a boat. Two, Summoner Wars, so he could use the board, quote-unquote, as a sail. And three, Agricola, so he could leave it behind on the island.
Oh,
that's awesome.
Ooh.
You know, I'm sensing a theme, the coffin boxes for Fantasy Flight getting used an awful lot as boats or weapons.
That's right.
Alan Padfield says, one, Agricola, because there are bound to be survivors hanging onto the side of the boat, and they will undoubtedly fall asleep during a game of Agricola and drift off with the waves. Two, Battlestar Galactica, using spare loyalty cards to increase the player count, except that any players that are eliminated using the rules in Exodus are removed from the game for good and are thrown out of the boat. You get the idea that Alan is trying to limit the number of people that go on his boat with
him. I see that's a theme, too.
And three, Arkham Horror. Now that we are down to four or five players, there would be room to spread out a coffin box game, and so long as there are no veteran gamers present, Arkham Horror would keep us occupied for days until we reach land or get rescued. And those are the entries that did not have audio files attached.
All right.
So that was a good job reading those, Craig. Very dramatic.
Well,
reading.
Thank you. Thanks. Well, I didn't want them to, you know...
Right.
To get punished.
I still think it's fascinating that underlying theme about, you know, my whole family may not make it, which is more time to game, is very kind of disturbing.
It is alarming.
All right. Let's see who's next here.
Something being said there.
And finally, Oop. One of our listeners who happens to be a comedian, Joe Vespasiani, didn't have time because he was on the road to do an entry, so he actually sent us just a little bit of a clip from his new CD that I thought was funny enough that I'm going to throw it on here without even telling Russ I did it.
Ooh, look at that.
So without further ado, just one.
This is actually a bootleg.
What's that?
It's actually a bootleg that he sent.
Oh, cool.
And I'm still convinced that I'm misspelling his name. Mispronouncing his name. But
and there's more entries after this because you didn't tell me it was here, so I stapled on even more.
Correct.
So we'll keep going. But here, let's listen to this a little bit.
From Joe Vespasiani, and I believe you can find him at... JOEVES.com. Yeah. Here we go.
Or not.
Or not. Interesting. Maybe
what's going on there?
Maybe too big.
But I got my kids a game one time, too, and this was a big fiasco. Because I got him Operation. I loved that game as a kid. That was a great game. Operation was a great game as a kid. I just loved it. Because I knew I wasn't going to med school. Right? I didn't like school and I didn't care for people that much. So I thought, well, I don't want to go to that much trouble. But I do believe that you should know something. You should know how to help somebody. I thought, if I'm good enough at this game, if I perfect this game, I can be that guy in an emergency situation that would handle something crazy, you know, like some sort of big crazy, you know, the world's blowing up and the cars are some giant man in front of me, some, you know, 300-pound man gets thrown clear from his vehicle through the sunroof and all his clothes are ripped off him except for his underwear and he lands on the side of the road with gashes in his body. I can deal with him right away. I go, oh, sure, I got this. Relax. I got to put this light bulb in your face there. Thank you. I'm going to go back to my car. I'm going to get my big tweezers. I'm going to come right back and I'm going to start with the bread box that's on your chest right now. Going to get that? That's probably why you can't breathe right now. I got a big bread box pushing against your lungs. I'll take care of that. I might go get that butterfly. That's probably annoying, that thing. I'm not going to try the rubber band on your thigh there. I can't do that. That's always giving me trouble. I'm not going to do that. Wait for the professionals to help you with that.
All right. That's pretty funny.
Okay.
Here's our next.
Okay.
So now here we're back to the contest. Little break there, apparently.
Little break.
All right. So this is our next entry in Escape from Atlantis. Here we go. Back to the contest.
Okay. Sweetie, if you get this message, I need you to... Oh, God. All right, the storms are coming. As you can tell, Atlantis is sinking, and we have to get out of here. Now, unfortunately, we did not win the lottery, and so we're not going to be part of the group that's going to go aboard that boat heading for Mount Olympus. We don't have a ticket aboard the Titanicus, so we're going to have to survive on our own. According to our fearless leader that we've elected, that Alfredus E. Newman, that madman, he's going to send us out to the Rafe Reef Islands. It's a bunch of deserted islands. It's really kind of crazy. He's sending only 50 random people to each island, and it's, I don't know. So don't say that you know me. He's also authorized us to pillage the city to take whatever we need, but at a limit of 3 items apiece. So you go to the grocery store and get milk and eggs and bread in case we want to make some French toast while we're on that island. The storm. I'm going to go and I'm going to raid the game store so that we can, play games while we're on the island. I think it'll be fun. I put some thought into it. I wanted to get something, something that a lot of people could play, an introductory game. Oh, God. I was thinking about Werewolf, but, based upon the fact that we had that actual Werewolf incident a month ago, I think it's just too soon. Just too soon for Werewolf. So I'm going to go with the Wits and Wagers. It's got it's trivia, but you don't actually have to know the trivia. It's all numbers and guessing and betting. You can play in teams or individuals. I think it'd be a really great introductory for games to bring people in. For the second game, I think I'm going to go and I'm going to pick up something that's got some more theme, lots of bits, a nice board. Oh, God. lots of people can play, and it has good random, screw your neighbor kind of elements to it. So I think I'm going to get Battlestar Galactica. Yeah, that's what I'm going to get. I'm going to get Battlestar Galactica. That'll be great. So I'm going to bring that to the island. And the storm. I think for the third game I'm going to get, I want to get something with, again, lots of great pieces, good thematic to it, but a two-player game, something that just you and I can play, baby, if you're part of the 50 that comes to the Ray Free Island with me. But I was thinking maybe getting a Space Hulk. Yeah, Space Hulk. Great bits, great parts, good thematic. And it's, a great two-player game. All right, sweetie. I hope to see you there. Again, raid the grocery store. I'm going to raid the game store. And, we're going to go out to those desert isles. So, I love you. And, I hope to see you there soon. Bye!
Very nice.
I like the Twitter reference in there about the French toast. That was awesome.
Yeah, that's hilarious. Why is that a Twitter?
Oh, that was a thing. I retweeted about it whenever there's a winter storm in New England, everybody races out to the grocery store and buys all the eggs, milk, and bread. Uh-huh. And I said that must be because everybody enjoys French toast in the snow. That was the joke. Uh-huh. So anyway, so we got it in there, which is kind of cool.
You're like a comedy genius.
That was him. He had a better setting though with the whole Atlantis sinking thing.
Ah, yes.
So here we go. So on to next one. What's we got here?
Avasti landlubbers, I be here to teach you how to escape from Atlantis with your bellies intact. First thing you'll need be descent, so that when the great whale comes and sinks your sloop, you can use the descent box to stay afloat. Second be the Pathfinder rulebook, so you can clobber any sharks with your 500-page book. And lastly, when the great sea monster appears and you're forced to throw your third shipmate aboard to it, you'll need summoner wars, so you'll still have something to play with your first mate. If you follow these rules, you will live to survive the escape from Atlantis.
Oh, very nice.
Nice. I like the pirate sound.
Got the title in there, too.
Exactly. Very nicely done.
Good evening, passengers. Welcome aboard Adios Airlines, Flight 513 to London, Bradley, and Las Vegas. You may unfasten your seatbelts at this time. We do ask, however, that you observe the no-smoking signs to minimize the chances of us blowing up while in the air. Just kidding. Our flight today is under the command of Captain Russ Kamikaze Wakeland. Our co-pilot is Craig Gallant, and your navigator for this flight is Rafe Hollywood Granger. In case we do run out of luck while flying, your flight attendants would like to acquaint you with the safety features on board the 787. There are four emergency exits on board. Two located at the front of the cockpit. The other two are located at the rear of the cockpit. For your safety, a package of animal balloons is provided directly underneath your seats. In the unlikely event that we take a dive into the turbulent waters below, simply blow up the balloons, creatively twist them around your arms, and you're ready to go. Look, a swan! As there are a number of deserted islands under our flight path, if you do find yourself swimming in the drink, just locate a deserted island with a Walmart and swim on toward it. Note, no more than 50 to an island. After all, they are deserted. For your entertainment, under your seat, you will find a copy of City of Thieves from Fantasy Flight Games. In the overhead compartment, we provided an inflatable backpack with a complete set of rule books for Vampire the Masquerade. You might never actually get to play the game, but they sure make a great read. You'll also find decks of cards, miscellaneous dice, a chessboard, none of which are included for the contest, but are somehow erroneously included for this entry. And another board game, Risk, from Hasbro. Lastly, in the seat pockets in front of you, you'll find Small World from Days of Wonder. Great family fun. We will be arriving in London in approximately 3 hours, and we hope your stay is enjoyable and memorable. So on behalf of Adios Airlines and all the captain and crew, adios! And thank you for flying Adios Airlines.
You know, I just now got the joke about 50 per island.
Yeah,
it took me
yeah.
a while to get that joke. I was like, why do they keep picking 50? Because several people did. I was like, is it related to Survive? And then I remembered it was your whole segment there. That was hilarious.
Yep, yep.
Right. All right, that was a good one. Although, not really about Survive, because they're in an airplane. But I guess it's surviving an airplane crash. We'll go with that.
Well, they're leaving Atlanta.
Hey, D6G. Oh. Here's my entry for your contest. Cue the rainfall. Atlantis is sinking into the ocean. Craig's prediction was right. Oh, no. We only have seconds to get our best board games from our collection. Quick, Wilson, run over there and grab me Fireball Island, the three-dimensional adventure game of rip-roaring action and heart-pounding suspense.
Old school.
Charlie, fly over there and grab me those overly loaded storage bins with Carcassonne and all the official expansions. Oh, yes, that includes Inns and Cathedrals, Traders and Builders, Princesses and the Dragon, the Tower, Abbey and the Mayor, the Catapult, Wheel of Fortune, Bridges, Castles, and Bazaars. And don't forget the mini expansion Sashel next to it with the River, King and Count, the Cathars, Count of Carcassonne, the River 2, the Colt, Tunnel, Crop Circles, the Plague, and I think that's all of it. I hope you can manage. Douglas, get out of your underground secret lair and help me with the game Laser Battles. Freaking lasers! How can you get better than that? Okay, everybody, in the rowboat. Hollywood, man those oars. And don't worry, I grabbed the survival meal packs of rigatoni with meatballs.
Nice. Rigatoni with meatballs. I love it.
Mm. There was a terrible storm. And Atlantis fell below the sea. This is where you will find Johnny's story. Johnny the gamer, who saved the most treasured games from Atlantis. Alright, Johnny, we be here. We be here, we made it, we're on the boat. What did you bring? What about your life and kids? You didn't bring them?
No. No, I didn't.
Why not? What did you bring instead?
Games.
Games? But what games? Come on, Johnny. You can't just bring games with you.
Yes, I can.
Oh, you're going to teach us how to live again.
Yep.
Back in the real world.
Yeah.
Okay, what games you got?
Well, I brought three games, three important games there, Daniel. The first one teaches us
about carving our own place in the world now that Atlantis is gone. This is civilization. The board game, not the computer game. All the technology of Atlantis gives me the jitters now. But wait a minute, if we can conquer, we can build marvelous things taught by the game of life, of civilization. Then maybe, maybe, just maybe, we should learn to farm. That's right, farm. Daniel, you were an awesome farmer. You used to beat me at a curriculum all the time. Now you will use it to teach the generations. Six generations how to farm and how to make it in the world. The last game, the third game, the game that will help us all, that will help us all live again. Well, that's simple. We've decided, well, I've decided, because I'm better than you, I've decided to bring the Zen for two reasons. The first reason is it'll teach me how to become an overlord of extreme power, and it'll also teach you, Daniel, how to lose. Because when you play Agricola, well, you pull me at death sometimes, but you win. You win. And I want you to lose. So I'm going to use my lieutenants and beat you down. You can maybe be a lieutenant if you want to try. But I carve my new world out using civilization. Second reason that I went for it, this pretty big box. So if we take all the contents out and fill it with some air, we can use it as a life raft if anything happens to the boat. Hey, Daniel, you see that over there? What is it? That doesn't look natural, Daniel. Looks as if it might. There was a terrible storm indeed, and in that storm, there was a simple man emerged. It was not Johnny, even though this is Johnny's tale. It was actually Daniel, his trusty sidekick, who brought us the three hallowed games of Atlantis. And without that, we would not have the civilization we have just now. For Daniel went on to build great farms and mine. He builds a great wonder and eventually gets to space before his oppressors. And for those that he could not conquer through peace and politics, well, he had descent to help. Descent taught him to use his lieutenants, who we all named Johnny. And they all died pretty quickly, actually. But he's hired great, great kid called Craig. I had some sons and more sons, and they had sons, and they had sons, and so on and so forth, until the mighty Rafe, Russ, and Craig would podcast about their finds, about the great, great games of Atlantis.
Well, that's it, folks. That's all of them.
Wow. That's a lot.
That was
he whispering so his wife wouldn't hear him because he's not bringing his wife?
I think so. That's a lot. That was definitely a very disturbing theme.
Yes, it was.
So I think before we pick our winners, do you guys remember, what do you think the most common game chosen was?
Small World seemed to be picked a lot.
I think Descent was in there a lot, too.
And Descent, due to the size of the was box in there. Top.
Descent, I think, used more as a boat than a game, I think. but yeah, I think those are two big ones. A lot of Carcassonne, right? A lot of general play games. Yeah, there's good choices, great choices in there. And a little Werewolf. Some games we don't talk about very much in the show, but I'll made in there, too, which is great. So good stuff. Yep.
I would say Small World probably won out, but Descent looks very much like it's a close second.
I think so. So, okay, so what are our top two or three or one, if you only have one? Or do you have a clear winner? So I think I actually have a clear winner, despite them all being so close and awesome.
Really? So you're not even going to take advantage of your ability to choose three?
I don't know. I think Well,
give us the runners up then.
Oh, here's my – okay, you want me to start first?
Yes.
My three favorites, they were all fantastic, so it was really hard. But the ones that I thought really brought a lot together, I like Spookies with the it was sort of an Atlantean address, you know, from the president of Atlantis, and he had the points for the meeples in the air, and the 1 point go swimming, and the 3 points get the boat. I like that one. I loved the husband and wife team one. Yeah. Where they didn't really give their name, but they had like the Wongs, and there was the lifeboat, and they had there's an argument about the Antarctic. I thought that was great because I like how they brought the whole debate about where Atlantis was along with all that. I thought that was great. And they had really good chemistry. Like the banter was really, really well done. But my favorite by far is the Irish song. Because I think the presentation was good. It was the most probably unique of all of them. Yeah. And I think of all of them, despite them all being hard to do, having tried to write a song or two myself and failed miserably, I think that was probably one of the hardest ones in terms of time and takes and effort. So So I'm that's my vote. Those are my three, but I like the Irish song the best.
Okay. So Rafe, what do you
want to go next? I picked the top six, so I'm going to narrow down
to three.
Go through six. I'm going to narrow down two, and then my winner. So I think a runners-up was the couple. Definitely the had good audio. The Antarctica reference was funny. I'm like, ooh, we have a woman that listens to the podcast, or at least
there was a couple.
Yeah, there was a couple.
Yeah, yeah. I think that was the first one, maybe in the series. And I was like, oh, that's cool. So they were runners-up. I liked as my other runners-up, of course, Granger and Stoney. And I thought the sound effects on that one were funny. But for me, the winner is the singing German, singing the Irish song. I mean, that was just, I couldn't believe how in tune he was. I mean, he was a good singer.
Yeah.
So he's my winner.
Yep, we had two overlaps, Rafe, but we both picked the same number one. So, Craig, what do you pick?
Okay. I have to give, it doesn't really, I'm now going to break the rule that I just told Ray he couldn't break.
Here we go. Craig's now to provide 10. Here we go.
Yeah. Well, I have to give at least an honorable mention to The Nature of the Pole, because that's a classic.
That was a classic.
I would have to say that I really liked let's see, what are the other ones? Actually, I'll go with three.
All right.
I loved Spooky's.
Okay. Yeah, Spooky's was great.
I thought his was extremely, not only well done and extremely clever, as always, with the sound effects and everything else, but especially because it's St. Patrick's Day, I too have got to go with Stefan from Germany and his song.
Yes.
Great.
I have.
So, Stefan, you are the winner. Well
no,
done.
D6G.
Well done, sir. So, all right, here we go. So Stefan, well done. Send us your address, and we will make sure we mail out your big prize box, which is Escape from Atlantis, and Code 777, and the Meeple expansion for Survive Escape.
Good on you, mate.
Well done, sir. And the song will indeed be played at PaddyCon, probably more than once.
Probably.
So great. So, and thanks to everyone. They were fantastic. Yeah, I have not laughed this hard on the show in some time. No. That was really, really good. And all of them were awesome.
Like all of you. And, I mean, so much work. So many of these had such awesome special effects and recording quality. And really, you guys have really stepped it up since the old days.
It was fantastic. And I hope everybody enjoyed listening
to
as much as we did. That was great.
It was awesome.
Good stuff, folks, and we'll have another contest in the not too distant future.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. Born to game.
My favorite tagline of all times, the War Store, bringing the war to your door since 1999, and that's for a decade or more.
Woo!
It's one of my favorites because Craig made that up.
Anyway, so yeah, they've been in business since 1999, the best possible website for buying stuff for your gaming.
Easy to navigate, got all your Flames of War that you could ever want to look at, see all the pics, it's all there.
Best price.
Not only that, it's the best place to go for sneak peek photos, too.
Oh, yeah, you know.
I didn't realize that.
I do go there. Whenever something's been announced or coming out, I often go to the War Store because they very often, sometimes, I don't know how they do it, but they have pictures up of stuff you can order often before it even gets to the manufacturer's site.
Yeah, the new Spartan spaceships for Firestorm Armada.
Yeah, but don't tell anybody that because then they might stop doing it. It's just our little secret.
That's right. Mm.
Right.
You guys, just don't tell anybody, but you guys go there if you want to see a picture.
Right, of something new.
and of course, don't forget that the War Store is going to be at the Colonial GT in Princeton, New Jersey.
Ooh, cool.
So they're still out and about. They do not stop.
No, they don't. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, no, go ahead.
I see some new products they're featuring, some things that you guys like, the Malifaux Rules Manual.
Yeah, the little new one.
By the way, I checked out on the Weird website. They've combined the both books, the rule set, into one manual. There's no pictures or fluff, I understand. It's just the rules. So that's pretty cool. You can get some dystopian pre-orders, and some of your – oh, my gosh. You guys are going to go nuts. Craig, you can get Magic the Gathering card singles now.
Do you not listen to the ads when you listen to the show? That was from last episode. But that's okay, because all that and more are still available.
Right.
Now it's still kind of new then.
You can pre-order the Mantic game, Dwarf King's Hold.
Right.
You're looking at the beautiful new Avatars of War model. And as you know, they're in no way, shape, or form meant to be alternate sculpts for a large, giant game company's fantasy game.
No, of course not.
The Marauder Warlord kit, which looks friggin' awesome.
Right.
And, so there's all kinds of stuff. And Fort Buyaki Invitational 40K Tournament.
Oh,
and
sweet.
Those of you who remember Jason Buyaki, he used to run Grand Tournaments. And so now he kind of has his own in Secaucus, New Jersey.
Sweet.
You know those Vikings, they love their New Jersey.
Excellent. So check out the War Store for all your online gaming needs.
Indeed.
Hollywood Ranger, and this is the Hollywood Minute. All right, for this Hollywood Minute, I have a rather lengthy but interesting shout-out brought to you by Doc Rain. And I'm going to read the whole thing because it is Hollywood Minute worthy. Here's a story about being truly surprised as a dungeon master. The campaign was 3rd edition D&D set in Dark Sun. The three PCs, or player characters, longtime gamers and friends, were around 12th level, neutral evil aligned. One PC was a sorceress defiler. The closest analogy would be a dark side wielder in Star Wars. After having completed a particularly harrowing adventure beneath the sands of Athas, the PCs returned triumphant to the surface, ready for some R&R. The Defiler PC asked where the closest settlement was. DM, a village known to be ruled by preservers. Think Jedi. PCs, that's where we'll go. DM, you know the village is ruled by a council of preservers higher level than you. PC, that's okay. Long story short, the Defiler PC was captured and forced to undergo retraining as a preserver or live out his life in a dungeon. The PC went along with the retraining jovially and was really friendly with the whole village. In fact, all the PCs seemed to enjoy themselves and were ready to move forward being good aligned. At the end of the retraining, there was a celebration, and I informed the PC he lost half his levels and was now a level 6 sorcerer preserver. PC, nonchalantly, to random villager guard, may I borrow your polearm? DM, quizzically. Sure. PC, can I get a shovel? DM, sure. PC, I dig a small hole beside the house I have been living in and plant the polearm securely in the ground, blade upright. DM, okay. PC, I climb up the house and leap off and impale myself onto the polearm. That was the first and only time a PC committed suicide in one of my campaigns. Again, that was brought to you by Doc Rain. I have to say, and then the question is posed to me, Hollywood, when were you or were you ever truly surprised as either a PC or a DM? I've got to say, when I heard that story, I was just as shocked as the DM must have been in reading the shout out. I was like, holy cow, what an epic story. I could just picture the PC going along with it being very nonchalant and then sticking to his alignment, so to speak, and saying, I would rather die and kill my character than live on as a preserver. Or he was really miffed about being biffed in levels. So I've been racking my brain. I have to say that no, I cannot think of a time that I was really ever truly shocked. I can remember role-playing in college using the Warhammer Fantasy role-playing, And again, I did that because back in the day, there were just too many people that knew all the answers with D&D. And so this was a new setting. And I can remember role-playing with some good college friends of mine, Kristen, and there were some other guys that were, I think they were freshmen, and for the life of me, I suddenly can't remember their names. And they weren't really role players at all. And they had a blast playing it. And one of them was like a tiefling or basically a halfling. And I can remember a very funny episode where he stole a pie. So not being a role player, in other words, he didn't really care about combat and stuff like that. He would always role play these very funny instances like he used to read out of the Dragonlance novels. I can remember that. I can remember my very first character in D&D being a gnome illusionist. And I can remember all of us running around saying, "I disbelieve, I disbelieve, I disbelieve," anytime we saw anything. I can remember that same DM session when I was the GM. I mean, it went for years, and I did have a very complicated plot going on, and it was good versus evil, and they were the good guys, and in the end, they lost. They did not stop the sacrifice in time, and the evil won, and the planet was basically run asunder and filled with demons. And I thought that there would be boos and hisses and that they would be really angry that they lost. But it was a close battle. It wasn't like a fudge of a dice or anything. They just ran out on the global time clock, if you would. And they just thought that was the greatest campaign they've ever been in. And back in our college days, they still talk about it to this day. I can remember that. And then, of course, most recently, I'd have to say I was surprised at the lackluster GMing affair of the Death Watch, which, again, I totally see. I see their point. But I was surprised over the fact that I felt really good as a GM of matching everything that I had planned, and yet the player characters, again, wasn't what they signed up for. So I can think of that. But I have to say, I can't think of something that truly left me speechless or shockless. So, yeah, that was a great shout out. And that leaves me to thinking, hey, if you guys ever have something like that, where you've got a little bit of a story, depending on if it fits the right random element of my mood, send it on in. And you never know. Maybe it'll make a Hollywood Minute. I guess you have to win the bid, too. Please feel free to email me at hollywood@thed6generation.com if you have any epic GM as a PC or as a DM stories of when you were truly surprised. Well, that's all for me. See you in 2.
And now we want to talk about our newest sponsor, just on board for about a month now, or not even a month, half a month. Audible.com
is our newest sponsor. But Ross, you've been a member since when?
2004, baby.
Dude, wow. It's like you discovered the band,
I've been with them forever. They're fantastic. Now, Audible are the guys that, these guys have MP3 books on audio. Yeah. And I've been with them since before people really had a lot of MP3 players. In fact, when they started, they sent you as part of the package a little beat up little MP3 player to use because not everybody had one.
Oh, did they really?
Of course, now
they, like, sent you a narrator and he sat in your passenger seat.
That would have been awesome. But hello, I'm Jim Dale. I'm going to ride with you to work and narrate a book from memory, no less. But you know what is great about Audible, and I think you guys have discovered this too, is when do you have time? Some of our listeners talk to us. You guys are talking about all these great books on the show. When do you find time to read? Well, I have found time to read. I've always had really bad commutes. I still drive about an hour and a half each way to work. That's 3 hours in the car a day.
Mm-hmm.
And, that's 15 hours a work week. And, podcasting, even a nice big D6G episode of 4.5 hours, still got 10 hours left to listen to something. And there's nothing on the radio. So I love listening to books. In fact, and I got all this huge collection of books now, over 230 of them, I'm sitting on them. And you own the books forever. And I'm able to, the new George R. Martin books coming out this summer. I've got the whole Fire and Ice series, or Ice and Fire. I've had it since 2006. It's still in the cloud. It's not taking any space on my hard drive. I can go back, download it anytime, and re-listen to those books. And I'm going to do that this summer.
Oh, really? You don't have to store them?
No, it's all in their cloud.
Oh, wow.
I can go back. I've had The Dark Tower on there, one of the first books I got, back in 2004. I can re-download that, listen to the whole thing, and be ready for the new Stephen King Dark Tower book coming out.
Yeah, I do like that kind of feature. So, Xbox does the same thing, so I know exactly what you're talking about.
Fantastic. So now, Craig, you just jumped into the plan. Now, the plan is, that you go to either our website and click on the Audible logo, or you can go to audibletrial.com/D6G.
Yep.
You get 14 days free. You get a free book credit that gives you a book that's yours to keep. And, Craig, you did that. Now, you think you're going to stay on?
I have been staying on, actually.
Now, why do you like it? Because you were like, I'm just going to try it, and then I'll ban
probably. Well, I love my library, and I actually am still using my library for books that they have. But the thing is that the library, especially for fantasy and sci-fi, is very limited.
It's like hit or miss, right?
Right.
But yeah, exactly. And it's like, did some librarian 5 years ago enjoy Song of Ice and Fire? Because if she did, bing, there's the. But did she enjoy, Honor Harrington? No, well, then that's not on there.
Right.
And the best example is right now, as everybody knows, I'm trying to churn my way through the Miles Vorkosigan series, which is extremely difficult to figure out what order you're supposed to read them in because she didn't write them in chronological order. So it's very odd to try to figure it out. And they only have probably about 75% of the books at the library.
Right.
So there were holes, and I was like, oh, crap, what am I going to do? And now what I did with my free book, what did I get? I didn't get my free book.
Leviathan or Behemoth, right?
Yeah, I got Behemoth.
Right.
But the thing is that what you need to know as a member, you get these special prices, which is awesome, for anything. You get a credit a month, basically, for almost any book.
Yep.
But you also get these special prices that you pay once you've used up your credit and special deals. For instance, right now there's, I think it's 250, oh no, 50 more just got added. So it's 300 books that are on there for $5.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
And so for less than the cost of the paperback, I got the book Ethan of Athos, which is a book that you can't find on audio anywhere and was the next book in the series that I needed to read. And it's not it's a little wacky because Miles Vorkosigan's not in it, but it's the same universe and it's one of the main characters that's in it. And it was awesome and I really enjoyed it. And I wouldn't have been able to follow along in the order that I wanted to read or listen to them without the Audible. So now I'm looking and there's two others that aren't in the library and I'll be getting those from Audible also. I mean, so for me, it's been an awesome deal. Because it costs, what, $14 or $15 a month?
Depends on there's different packages for the number of free books you want a month, but yeah.
Yeah, and so, like, I think that's the one, that's the lowest one for, like, one free book.
Right, yep.
And that's the one that they start you out on if you want to continue.
Right.
And so, like, so there you go. I mean, it takes a while to churn your way through one of these audiobooks.
Oh, yeah.
So you might not be getting more than one a month anyway.
I really miss it. I'm going to sign up again. I just have to... I've got this like home accounting I got to go through because Marisa keeps all the books. I was like, oh, here's my $20, so I can sign back on Audible. I just haven't done it, but I really, really, really miss it.
Well, the thing to remember too is those credits are good for any single book, and as Craig's mentioning, some of these books are long. I just finished Armor. Okay, great ending.
Which is awesome.
That was a 14-hour book. That was last month's credit, and it just ran out. And then you guys were talking about Name of the Wind, and I had not read that book. So I'm like, this month's credit just cycle back in. I'll get that. That's 28 hours of book.
That's what 800 pages looks like, baby.
Boom! Just there. Boom. That's going to take me the whole month to get through, so it's perfect.
Oh, you're going to love Name of the Wind.
So where else are you going to get 28 hours of entertainment for $14? You're just not. No. So it's a fantastic deal, so you definitely want to try it out. Go to our website, d6generation.com, click on the Audible link, or go to audibletrial.com/D6G for the great free trial and a book to keep.
This is Total Fangirl. Regular Jane most days, total fangirl when the moment strikes. Han shot first. Starbucks is a guy. And Lestat, now there's a vampire. Hey everyone, this is Nicole, your Total Fangirl. You can follow me on Twitter at Nicole Wakelin and check out my blog, totalfangirl.com. This week, our shout-out is, please go to wheresthetardis.com/entry/350 and vote on Flip's life-size balloon TARDIS every day until May 15th. You can also challenge him with Doctor Who balloons and follow his progress with a contest on Facebook and Flip's fantastical TARDIS contest campaign page. Thank you. I've actually seen this, and it is pretty amazing. It is a gigantic TARDIS built out of balloons, and it is definitely worth checking out and voting for. Before I get to my segment this week, I need to refute something that you either are going to hear or have recently heard, depending on where Russ puts it in the show. But I'm going to stand by this, despite the volumes of hate mail I'm liable to get. I don't like hobbits. I don't like hobbits, but I like Ewoks. I know, I'm supposed to hate the hobbits. I hate the Ewoks and love the hobbits, but I don't. Hobbits are these nasty little guys with the hairy, ugly feet who are always causing trouble and just looking forward to their next meal. Ewoks, on the other hand, are cute and warm and fuzzy, and they use stormtrooper helmets like little bongo things. So in my book, I don't care what Russ says, the Ewoks are cooler. But what I really wanted to talk about this week is something completely different. I went to see a movie this weekend. There are no spoilers, so don't panic. But in this movie, there were undead zombie Nazis, zeppelins painted up to look like sharks, guns, swords, bombs made from the propane tanks that you have underneath your little grill in the backyard, and fire-breathing dragons chasing scantily clad women through a castle. If you haven't figured it out, the movie I'm talking about is Sucker Punch. I couldn't wait to see this. When I saw the previews for this movie, where the girls were jumping around in a sort of anime-style craziness, I thought it was going to be fantastic. I was so excited. I could not wait to go. So we got tickets. We even sprang for the IMAX tickets, which still, in a way that I don't understand, you spend more to buy those suckers and secure them online than you do from a human person, which I would love to have someone explain to me. So we spent, you know, the equivalent of like 1 month's mortgage on tickets to go see this movie in IMAX. And it wasn't disappointing in some ways. It was absolutely beautiful. Those scenes that you see in the previews where they're fighting are incredible. They're so beautiful that you just want to jump out of your seat and cheer them on. They're over the top. They're insane. They make absolutely no sense. Everyone should have been killed every 10 seconds. There's no way that they should have survived everything that they survive, but it's still amazing and it's beautiful. And if you're a gamer and you like to do RPGs and you're, you know, moving miniatures across a board, pretending on their field of battle, this movie is like watching all your games come to life. It's fantastic. And from that point of view, this movie succeeded on such a level. It is worth seeing, absolutely. But where it failed for me was the story in here and the characters. Now, I know you're going to say, Nicole, it's an action movie. How much character development do you want? How much do you want to get into their heads? Well, I either want it to be an action movie or I want to get into their heads. And if you try to do both of them, you better do it really well. And that was the problem. I didn't think this really did a good job of telling me who these women were. I wanted them to win. I wanted them to succeed. I hoped it would all work out well in the end, and I was pulling for them all the way through. The problem was I really didn't care if they lost. When they were on the screen and they were fighting, when they were fighting zombie Nazis and samurais with glowing red eyes that were three stories tall, I was totally immersed in the movie and couldn't wait to see what happened next. When it pulled out of that particular world, then it got a little bit disjointed and didn't really draw me in. That was what the problem was for me. Did I want to go see it? Yes. Was I happy that I saw it and paid a small fortune to see it in IMAX? Yes. In fact, I would recommend you go see Sucker Punch if you haven't already, or when it comes out in your country, go see it. Pay the big bucks to see it in a really good movie theater, because the visuals and the music are amazing, and it's worth that experience just to see it in the movies. Just go for that eye candy thing. It's not really going to draw you into the characters, and it might be a little off-putting, but it is absolutely worth it just to see the eye candy. And as one of our friends put it, you know, chicks dressed like anime with plenty of scantily clad ladies dancing around the screen. So everybody will enjoy it. There you go.
Need to add a big unit to your current force and don't feel like painting that many grunts? Or maybe you want to start a new army and really don't have time to paint it up? That's where PaintedFigs.com can help. For over 4 years, their staff, with over 20 years of experience in the industry, have been providing gamers with high-quality, affordable paint jobs on miniatures for their most popular games, including Flames of War, Warhammer 40,000, Fantasy, War Machine, Hordes, and even a variety of board game pieces. Their full-service packages include the cost of the models themselves at wholesale prices, assembling, painting, and basing. And they now offer a super affordable dipping service starting as low as 99 cents per figure. Because they are able to get the models wholesale, you end up with a package appearing on your doorstep full of ready-to-play models at only a fraction over the retail price. That's why PaintedFigs.com is the official painting service of the D6 generation. Their name says what they do. PaintedFigs.com. high-quality miniature painting at the lowest rates on Earth, even with shipping. Be sure to let them know the D6 Generation sent you.
You're listening to the D6 Generation. More to game.
Hey, I want to talk to you guys all about Myriad Games, which is the official, friendly, professional game store of the D6 Generation.
Woo!
So I think I last told you guys I was really psyched. I got my trucks for Flames of War in lickety-split time, and that's just nice. One of the things that Dan offers. And in addition to that, I know he's been working on his website. What's been going on with that, Russ? Do you know?
Well, the website's totally rebooted. Looks beautiful.
Nice.
And they're doing a call to arms for all of our listeners out there. They have a big question up there. What's your favorite game store? So if you go to MyriadGames.com and click on the What's Your Favorite Game Store link, leave a comment and tell them what your favorite gaming store is and why you like them. They're trying to get all the great ideas out there and make sure that they and other stores know what you guys are looking for in stores. And also, they've got even more details coming up on their website soon about upgrades to the MVP memberships, which are the
most
great,
valuable player.
Right, which are ways you can put a little bit of money down a month to get your credit back on that money. So you really every penny you put down comes back to you in credit for games. But also, you get all kinds of great special deals. You get percentages back on your money for more games, entry to the play space, all kinds of crazy stuff.
So I have to say, I was a tough sell on the original MVP membership. You know, I was like, I don't know. I'll just go in and I'll buy what I want to buy when I want to buy it. I don't want to have an automatic debit come out of my account. But I like it, you know, because I like looking forward to like the first of the month. And I'm like, ooh, my Myriad money's going to come in. And then I can finally get Survive or like my next purchase I want to get is Merchant and Marauders if they still have it in print, you know. And it's,
right.
I got to admit, it's, I don't know. I know it's my own money, but it's fun because it feels like it's
like
free.
I like looking at it as a savings account.
Right. It's like budgeting. You're budgeting
exactly.
Your gaming allowance. And the other thing, too, if you want a free game, they can hook you up there, too, because on Facebook free Game Fridays, right? Facebook free, that's a lot of alliteration going on there. Basically,
that's even too much for you. Almost.
It is.
Right, and you love alliteration.
I do. I do like my first letters. So what you do is you go in there and you just like it. Just like their Facebook page. And you don't have to be local to win this drawing, by the way. You can be anywhere in the country.
And you don't have to be local
anywhere,
to be MVP.
Do you have to be in the country?
I think you can be anywhere in the world. I think Dan will probably hook you up. So just like his page.
Antarctica.
Right.
Sound off.
Right. Yeah. There you go, Dan. You got to ship to Antarctica now. There it is. So, yeah, and don't forget, this fall, Extra Life.
Absolutely. Early announcement that Myriad Games will again be taking part in Extra Life 2011, so there will be Team Game Salute active again on October 15th, 2011, and I'm sure we will be there with bells on.
Definitely, baby. So check it out.
This is the D6 Dice Demon, and when I'm not tormenting souls in Hades, I'm listening to the D6 Generation. Shouldn't you?
The D6...
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 Generation.
Dice are our vice.
Hello and welcome back, and now we're extremely pleased to have with us this evening Steve Kenson. How are you today, Steve?
I'm doing very well, thanks.
Well, thanks for coming on the show. Now, Steve, you are primarily an RPG designer. And we'll get to more of that in a bit, but we should point out, I think we need to mention that you come from a long line of New Hampshire-based game designers. Did you know this?
I did not know that there was a long line. I thought it was a relatively
Well, it starts
short
way
line.
Back in 1872.
Oh, really?
Eleanor Abbott was born in Wilton, New Hampshire, and she designed Candyland. It turned out she got polio and got sick in the hospital, and to entertain herself and the kids in the hospital, she designed Candyland.
Wow.
So there's her first New Hampshire designer. Then, of course, if you're a video game RPG fan, Origin Systems was based in Manchester, New Hampshire from 1983 on, and they did the Ultima series, right? So there's them.
No kidding. I didn't know they were based in Manchester, New Hampshire.
In fact, I got my first edition of Ultima 2 right from their manufacturing place there. It was awesome.
No way.
Yeah. And then Corey Kanitska, who is from Merrimack, New Hampshire, also there, Steve. He works for Fantasy Flight Games, and he makes big box titles such as Battlestar Galactica and StarCraft and Rune Wars and Mansions of Madness and other crazy games.
And the new Mansions of Madness, right?
And, of course, Steve Kenson, you as well. You actually predate Corey, but still we got you in there for last for dramatic effect. So
Mike Merles, who's the D&D brand manager at Wizards these days, is a Dartmouth alum.
There you go. Exactly.
He is?
Right.
Yeah.
Wow. I think we're rivaling Russ, Corey, and John over there, John and Cody over there Indiana for the gaming capital of the world. We have the game designers of the world.
They play the games in Indianapolis, but in New Hampshire we design the games and talk about them, apparently.
Right.
That's right.
So anyway, Steve, we always ask our guests this very first simple question. Are you now or have you ever been a gamer?
I'm pretty nearly a lifelong gamer.
How did it start? What was your first couple games that weren't like, you know, Monopoly and stuff?
My first role-playing game was actually the first edition of Gamma World.
Ooh.
Which I picked up, I guess I was in the sixth grade, and I saw it in a local Hallmark store of all places, and begged my parents to buy it.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
And they relented and have, I'm sure, regretted it ever since. But I spent, you know, a good chunk of my after school time and my summer after the sixth grade rolling up various weird mutants.
Nice.
You know, stuff with my friends, and it didn't take us very long to discover Dungeons and Dragons and import our Gamma World characters into D&D.
Right.
So that we could play the D&D modules with our Gamma World characters.
Now, did you play, what was it, S13, the one with the crashed spaceship?
Oh, remember that module? Expedition to the Barrier Peak.
Yeah, you had to, right? That was awesome.
Yep.
Because that was a nice tie-in with Gamma World, right? Because of the whole, like, yeah, it was awesome. So great. So it's kind of funny. So your RPG love affair began with sci-fi and then moved into fantasy.
Usually a lot of the interviewees, it's always, you know, D&D where it starts.
Right.
Yep.
Now, Steve, was this Gamma World? Was it the one with the bunny holding the rat, holding the gun, the machine gun, on the box?
Yeah, this is the gray boxed set.
Yeah,
nice.
I think I remember that as well. Although I can't remember if the one I bought was colored, so maybe that might have been second edition.
Right. Okay. Now, were you pretty much an RPG gamer, or did you also get into any kind of what we would call hobby board games back then?
I was pretty much a primarily RPG guy.
Okay.
I was not a big board gamer for the most part.
And have any video games ever captured your imagination, or you stay pretty much RPGs?
Strangely, I'm likewise not a big video game fan.
Very cool.
I've been known to just sort of casually play.
Dabble, if you will, right?
Dabble, if you will.
Right.
But the imaginative aspect of RPGs has always been the big thing that's appealed to me. So the restrictions imposed by the video game medium always kind of limits the amount of time I'm interested in them.
Okay, that makes sense. So let's talk RPGs then. So over the years, what have been some of your you mentioned you started with Gamma World. What are some of the games that really the RPGs that really captured your imagination throughout the years and kind of, I don't know, inspired you to do some of the stuff you worked on later?
Well, let's see. I didn't start out as a fan of the Marvel Superheroes game. I actually bought it and returned it to the store.
Oh wow!
because it was so radically different than the games that I was used to at that point.
Mm-hmm.
It kind of blew my mind, and at that point, I just was like, oh, this is a terrible superhero game, and I literally took it back to the store, and later I returned to the game after overcoming my initial shock, and discovered that I really liked a lot of the elements of it, and ended up running a very long and successful high school campaign with it. That started in many ways my really long love affair with superhero games.
Right. And we haven't mentioned this yet, but of course, Steve is best known for Mutants and Masterminds, probably as your RPG, but we'll get more to that in a little bit.
Yeah, and I have some questions too. Steve, Russ gets excited. He just starts like a freight train here sometimes. back to Gamma World, I'm just fascinated that was your first one. I found that game, what I remember of it, I wanted to like it, and I had a tough time. I think it must have been the rules, or it was too open-ended or something. I loved the fact that it was this open world and it was post-apocalyptic. And I'm really curious about you bringing it into your D&D. Before I think of why you did that, why did you bring it into D&D and not just play in the Gamma World setting?
Well, I guess it was a. I guess it really came down to the fact that there was more D&D material available.
Okay.
And, you know, we played through the available Gamma World adventures.
Yeah.
And I think that at the time there was maybe three of them.
Yeah, I think you're right.
You know, and so at that point we were hungry for more things to do. And I was making up adventures and, you know, coming up with different things. But there was this wealth of D&D modules out there. And to my, 12-year-old imagination, especially given the fact that the game systems were largely compatible, and the fact that they give a pretty clear wink and nod to the idea of crossing over Gamma World and D&D in both the Dungeon Master's Guide, the first edition, and one of the Gamma World mutations that involves interdimensional portals or something like that basically gives a sort of a nod to the idea that Gamma World characters could potentially visit a D&D campaign.
Yeah, I kind of remember that too.
And why not? That's why.
And were they
right,
both?
Exactly. And why the
and why not? So, right.
So,
were they both TSR?
Yeah.
They were.
Yeah,
okay.
Both very early TSR products.
Yep.
And so that idea kind of fired my imagination.
Okay.
So I had these D&D modules, and we had these Gamma World characters, and so I just thought the idea made natural sense as a way to give our Gamma World characters more things to do.
Yeah, right. I got into the Meteor Star Frontiers back then. See,
yep.
But I like Gamma World too, but it was a little crazy for my taste. But see, crazy sometimes is good.
Well, now I'm really excited to see how the origin story of in the industry from Gamma World to now your new, I shouldn't even say new product, but third edition product of Mutants and Masterminds, which I'm excited to learn about. So Russ, back to you.
Well, yeah. So let's figure that out. So you started playing. Mm-hmm. So you're playing your RPGs and you're getting into the superhero RPGs. At what point did you decide, gee, it might be kind of fun to make these things?
Well, that actually came about after a lapse in my superhero gaming. After I graduated high school and I was in college, my gaming buddies and I discovered Shadowrun, which was out in 1989. And we were just, that was our game of choice for quite a while. And we played a number of different games. My superhero campaign was kind of winding down at that point. I had basically run it all through high school and a couple of years after that. And it was starting to sort of wind down. And we were big into playing Shadowrun. So when Shadowrun 2nd Edition, a few years later, was in playtest, I was pretty actively involved back in the days of the 2400 baud modem on a gaming forum on the Genie network.
Oh, I remember Genie.
which was an online network run by GE.
Yep.
FASA, the publishers of Shadowrun, had had a forum there, and they were using the online forum to do some of their playtesting. So I became a playtester for the 2nd edition of Shadowrun, which was an opportunity for me and a number of other eager fans to, basically bring up all of our house rules and talk about all of our experiences with the game and things that we thought worked and didn't work and what have you. And when Tom Dowd was, who was the Shadowrun developer at the time, was looking to fill out some content in the second edition of the Grimoire, which is the magic source book for Shadowrun. He was looking for submissions because he had space to fill in the book. And so he was looking for people to submit new spells and abilities and those sorts of things. So I, you know, eagerly, you know, tore through my, you know, game notebooks and all of the stuff that I had put together for my own game. And I sent him a whole raft of stuff. and he liked it because he apparently, he used a fair amount of it in the book. And he asked me if I would be interested in writing an additional short essay for the book.
Oh, cool.
And, you know, I immediately, you know, jumped at that opportunity. I remember it was a short, like, maybe 1,000 words. It was barely a page and a half long, but I agonized over every word.
Yeah.
because I wanted to make sure that it was just right.
It's your first shot, right? You got to go for it.
And that led to some additional freelance work for FASA, working on Shadowrun, and later on Earth Dawn, which was their fantasy game. And that eventually led to my first novel contract with FASA. I wrote a Shadowrun novel called Techno Babble.
Oh, cool.
And it was around the time that I had finished my first novel that the idea occurred to me that, you know, there might be something to this writing thing, which I'd been largely doing in my spare time as a hobby. And especially given that I was in a fairly soulless corporate job that I really hated.
Right.
I decided that I would be much happier doing something that I really liked to do. So I did exactly what they tell you not to do, and I quit my day job. And I started freelancing in the game industry full-time. That was I did that for about 9 years.
Wow.
And was that...
That was starting in the mid-90s.
Now, was that... I mean, it must have been pretty scary when you started. I mean, how did you go from, you know, a few folks asking for your work to all of a sudden, did you feel like you had the portfolio or the contacts to have steady work, or what did you do? Did you just knock on doors?
I built that up. A lot of it was networking and getting to know people. A lot of it was going to conventions.
Right.
I've been to every Gen Con since 1990.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So. you know, I was, even before I was in the industry, I suspect I was a familiar face to some people at some different game companies. And, I started shopping around my business card and my writing samples and, you know, building up connections and talking to the people who I worked for and getting recommendations from them. And, you know, it's a lot of hustling and a lot of work to keep ahead of the curve.
Wow. So you ended up, well, so during that period, what were some of the big projects you were involved with that people might have known or recognize or know about?
Let's see. When you're freelancing full time, you pretty much work on anything and everything that you
can. Yeah, anything you can, right?
Right.
So I did a lot of work for FASA. I worked on Shadowrun all through second edition as well as on the design of third edition Shadowrun. I wrote parts of that core book and worked with the FASA staff on the design work for that. And that was really one of my first big, you know, from the ground up design projects of a new edition of a game. And I did a lot of work for Earth Dawn, which was just a tremendous amount of fun as a setting to work on. And lots of stuff all over the place, really. I did a fair amount of work for White Wolf.
Mm-hmm. Oh, cool.
Back in the day, particularly once they branched out into doing sci-fi games.
Right.
So I did a fair amount for Aberrant for a while. And sadly, adventure never lasted more than a book, so I never got to write anything
right.
for it. Pity, because I love that setting. And I didn't do a whole tremendous amount of stuff for TSR because I didn't get to start freelancing for TSR until they were bought by Wizards.
Okay.
At which point I did do some stuff for the Marvel Adventure game and for Dragonlance Saga. I was a big fan of the Saga system.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Various iterations.
Now, did you, when you...
I have a question for you, Steve.
Yep.
What is the, I mean, we have a lot of, you know, maybe potential budding game designers out there or novelists. And I'm not going to ask you, what tips do you have? You probably get asked that all the time. What I'm going to ask is what's the one thing that we, those of us that aren't in that, in your industry and do what you do, mm-hmm. that we think the job is like or does or gets or pays or whatever, that just is totally false? And I'll give you some time to think about. For example, I happen to be a lawyer by trade, and it's so funny when I get a chance to talk to young law students, and they think it's like TV. So that is to say, everybody's this really slick litigator with these beautiful suits, and they always have the perfect line, and they don't realize that real court is really like flipping through binders and, you know, looking up boring evidence cases, you know, things like that. Oh, and that we're all rich. That's the other thing that's hilarious.
Of course. Well, the two big ones with the game industry are one that you the great quote is, "Wow, it must be great because you get to play games all day."
Right.
And I think I'm pretty sure it was Aaron Alston, who's a novelist and game designer, who coined the phrase, "If you ever want to stop playing games, start writing them."
Right.
Because you will suddenly find your game playing time vastly decrease.
Yes.
So I do still manage to regularly play with my gaming group that's still together from college, our college days.
Oh, excellent. That's cool.
But not nearly as often as we have because we're, you know, grown-ups with mortgages and in many cases kids.
Right.
But certainly, you know, it's game design and working in the game industry isn't sitting around playing games all day.
Mm.
It's a job and it's work like everything else, and oftentimes very hard work. So it's not all necessarily fun. And of course, the other big thing is what you hear about most industries is that people think that, you know, game designers are making money hand over fist, and I can tell you that's definitely not true.
Even if it gets published and stuff, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Even you know, the top tier people who are working for Wizards, I'm sure they're, and I don't honestly know how much they make, but I'm sure they're making a decent living. But you know, I think that pretty much people in the game industry could be making more money doing almost anything else.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The reason that we're all in the game industry is because it's something that we really love to do, not because we're getting paid a lot of money for it.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's the same for us on our podcast. You know, it's like a labor of love.
Right.
And it's fun. Yep. Now, before Russ goes on, I do have the flip side of that coin, which is, what maybe did you expect it working in the industry to be like, and then you were pleasantly surprised? It either wasn't like, or something you didn't even expect that's neat.
I don't know that I really went into it with a lot of expectations.
Okay.
But I guess that I guess my favorite thing about the industry is that it's very intimate. It's a very small industry overall compared to a lot of others. So everybody knows everybody pretty much.
Oh, okay.
You know, in spite of what a lot of people will make out as company rivalries or, you know, competition, you know, oh, well, you know, you publish a fantasy game and they publish a fantasy game and, you know, don't you guys hate each other? You know, not really. I mean, everybody in the industry, we all know each other. You know, we all hang out in the same bars at cons, you know, we, you know, swap, you know, employees and freelancers.
We're all
from
New Hampshire, you know, these kind of things.
Right.
Right. You know, I mean, anybody who's worked in the industry for any length of time, especially if they've been a freelancer, has pretty much worked for everybody.
Right. Right.
So, you know, it's kind of hard to, it's much more of an extended family in a lot of ways than, you know, it is coldly corporate.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So, So let me ask you this. So you were freelance for a while, and yeah. And then, though, you got how did the whole going to work for someone, go back to work for someone work out? How did that happen?
Well, basically, I one of my freelance projects was designing a superhero setting, and which was a big dream project of mine. And unfortunately, as is sometimes the case in freelance projects, especially in publishing, plans for the product didn't work out.
Okay.
And the project basically fell through. So I had done a fair amount of design work, and basically, you know, just had to kind of put it aside. And it became sort of a pet project of mine because I, you know, was really it was having fun with it. So it became my so-called fun project that, you know, I would just work on in my spare time and tinker around with. And you know, other people restore cars, I create superhero worlds.
Right.
So it grew considerably as I continued to work on it and fleshed out a lot of details and, you know, tinker around with ideas. And so I was, this is where we get back to, you know, everybody in the industry kind of, you know, hanging out and knowing each other. I was chatting with Chris Premis, who's the president of Green Running Publishing, and who's a friend of mine. We were talking, and I happened to say that, you know, I've got this superhero, you know, project that I've been working on for a while, and I have nothing I can do with it because at the time we were talking, there was literally no superhero role playing game in print. Nobody was publishing a superhero game.
Wow, they're the old ones, right? Like Champions and Village of Vigilantes and stuff, but those are gone, right?
Yeah, even Champions at that point was kind of moribund. It was in this legal limbo over its ownership. You might recall the Champions New Millennium Edition,
right?
They used the fusion system rules.
Yep, I do remember
that trade name and setting and all of that stuff had been sold to a .com developer in the Silicon Valley area,
right?
And had sort of disappeared, vanished into limbo. And it was entirely unclear whether anyone was ever going to publish anything for it again, who really owned it, or what was going on with it. So there was literally no active superhero game. So I was like, you know, there's no market for it at all. There's nobody I can sell it to. And
right.
This was right around the time when the open game license and the D20 license were really taking off.
Right.
Right after D&D 3rd Edition had launched.
So what year, just to give people a time frame? Like, we're talking like mid-90s?
So we're talking like very late 90s,
okay.
Maybe like 2000.
Okay.
Thereabouts. But yeah, like 1999.
But right before the big superhero movie resurgence.
Yes.
Right? So good timing.
And Chris had started Green Ronin, in fact, off of the open game license by publishing what was one of the very first 3rd edition D&D adventures, Death in Freeport,
right.
Which he, likewise, because he was working at Wizards at the time, started out as a sort of side project. And so, you know, these were the days of the open game license, and people were just creating all kinds of new things.
Mm-hmm.
Based off of it. And so Chris said, well, I'll tell you what, you know, send me the setting and I'll take a look at it. And so I did. And he came back to me and said, you know, I think this has a lot of potential. If you're interested in designing a superhero game using the open game license, we'll set up a 2-book deal where we'll do the core rule book for the game, and we'll do this setting as the core setting book for the game. And I was like, really? A D20-based superhero game? It's going to be kind of stupid. You know, I mean, oh, I'm a 10th-level superhero. You know?
right.
You know, and I was like, all right. But I really wanted to publish my setting.
Right.
And so I was like, okay, let me think about it. you know, I'm like, because it's really the only opportunity I've got. And I really did want to work with Chris's company. So I went away and I thought about it, and I started, I downloaded all of the system resource documents for the D20 system and started taking things apart and, you know, really looking at how they worked. Now, I had played third edition D&D by this point, but I hadn't really sat down and done a real, you know, sort of get under the hood, you know, take a carburetor apart, see how the
game works.
And as I did that, I was like, you know, this could work. This has some potential. And so I wrote up a proposal, and it had a couple of departures from the way D20 handled things. I pitched it to Chris, and he liked it. And so that was basically the process that greenlit the initial design for the first edition of Mutants and Masterminds, and the creation of the Freedom City source book, which is the setting that I worked on to become its first setting.
Very cool. That was what, 2002, 2003, something like that?
That was, that was 2000. Well, the game came out in 2002.
Okay.
So you were just buttoning up. But it was about pretty close to a year of design.
Wow.
So, after the first edition took off, Green Ronin was looking, because, you know, we're a tiny company, was looking for somebody to come on board to handle the game full time, because it had become a full-fledged game line of its own and needed some management. So I hired on with Green Ronin to become the line developer for Mutants and Masterminds, which led to the development of the second edition of the game. And I pretty much oversaw the game until the beginning of the third edition, when John Lighthouser took over as developer.
Okay. Are you still with them now, though, right? Or
I am. My technical title at Green Ronin is that I am a designer. So I've kind of stepped away from the development side of things to focus more on the game design and writing stuff, which
big picture, honestly is picture stuff, right?
Big picture, and honestly, more where my talents lie.
Okay, mm-hmm. Well, that's cool.
See, that's the fact that it's a D20 system is what intrigues me the most, and I'm excited to hear how the game developed and what the game is like, because I have this problem or flaw, this role-playing flaw, where anytime I try to play anything other than D&D or the percentile-based systems like the ones coming out of Fantasy Flight games like Dark Heresy and Death Watch, and Ian, who introduced us to you, and he's going to be running a Mutants and Masterminds campaign coming up. Right. And he's only doing a second edition, which I'm really mad about, because now I want to try the new third edition. But anyway, and he lets us all the source books are out for the second edition. And so I'm hesitant, because he just ran a Star Wars one, and I'm like, every time I try to play, I'm a big comic fan, a big comic reader.
Sure.
I don't know how to play anything other than Spider-Man, and that's, or Batman, or Superman, or Captain America, or these characters that are already created. Even if I create a merge between Spider-Man and Captain America, I still feel like I'm just repeating what's already been done. Mm-hmm. And so I'm really curious to where you, it seems like your niche is the superhero world. I'm really curious to hear about Mutants and Masterminds and how it develops and how it plays and how it works with the D20 system, which is what I'm familiar with and I guess tend to love.
Sure. Well, basically, at its core, Mutants and Masterminds is the essence of the D20 mechanic that has been, you know, stripped down to, you know, the basic, you know, roll a 20-sided die, add the appropriate ability or modifiers, and compare that against a difficulty class. And
makes sense.
You know, I took that basic mechanic and simply extended it to apply to the way everything in the game works. So pretty much everything in the game system is some variation of that basic concept.
Mm-hmm.
The primary difference that you'll find in Mutants and Masterminds as opposed to other D20 games is that the game doesn't make the use of ablative hit points, which was one of the things that eliminated the need for a lot of other dice. Because primarily in most D20 games, those other dice come into play when you're talking about doing damage rolls.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I hadn't thought of that.
You know, it's mostly you're rolling the 4 and 6 and 8-sided dice for damage.
For damage, for the type of weapon you have.
Right. And that was problematic early on in the game's development because superhero levels of damage either had to be scaled to the point where normal characters effectively couldn't do or take any damage at all,
mm-hmm.
Or players had, you know, massive numbers of, you know, it's like you would be in a situation of, you know, all right, now you roll, you know, 19d6, you know, add them all up. And it was just, it was really not a lot of fun.
I hadn't thought of that. You're absolutely right.
So the system basically uses the same check mechanic to determine the effects of damage, where basically how damaging an attack is determines its damage class, same thing as a difficulty class.
Right.
And the character who is resisting the damage makes a toughness resistance check, which is just a d20 roll plus the character's toughness modifier. And the results of that roll determine basically how damaged the character is, anywhere from basically shrugging the damage off to being knocked out by it. And there are a couple of, you know, gradations in between, you know, from being, you know, minorly staggered or stunned to, you know, really pretty badly beaten up.
That's brilliant. I hadn't thought of that. See, I don't think like a game designer. I'm just an idiot. I'm just an idiot game player. And you're right. So now I never thought of that. If you're playing the Hulk type of a character,
yep.
And I hurl a piece of concrete at Russ, and he's a colossus.
Yep.
What does he have, 2,000 hit points, or his toughness, his armor class is 300? So, no,
right.
The way you just described it, it makes total sense. You just make the strength roll to rip the concrete mm-hmm. out, a
yep.
difficulty test with whatever bonuses I have. I have super strength, so that gives me +5 or
right.
whatever. And he's the colossus, so he's made of armor, and he has toughness. That makes total sense. Oh, I'm excited now.
So, well, let me go ahead.
That's basically how everything in the game works.
Well, that sounds awesome. Now, when Mutants Masterminds came out, it was very, very well received, right? And it won a lot of awards.
Are you talking about version 1, Russ?
Yes.
Okay.
Initially,
yeah.
Right? So it did very, very well, obviously, and that's what spawned the whole company, you know, hiring you on and doing everything else. And obviously, the mechanics being D20 probably appealed to a lot of people, but I'm sure there's more than that. What do you think, what's sort of the elevator pitch? What separates Mutant Masterminds from the other superhero games that are obviously, you know, back out again, or just in general, what do you think so appealing about it? What do you think keeps people coming back to the game?
Well, I think there are a number of things. One of the first things was that we were very fortunate when the first edition was in production. We were working with a production house called Super Unicorn, which was included Eric Mona, who's the publisher over at Paizo now.
Right.
Eric and the Super Unicorn guys really provided the graphic design
mm-hmm.
For the first edition of the game, and ever since we've stuck to the idea of the game having a very, very strong visual element because it's a comic book based game, so you know, you expect it to look like a comic book.
Right.
And so we've tried as much as possible to make all of the Mutants and Masterminds books full color, to feature really good superhero artwork in them, and to, you know, just really capture a lot of the visual feel of the comic books that inspire the source material.
Great. So
I think that's...
So it's got the complete package, right? It's a nice looking
yeah.
game, great mechanics, and it captures a lot of what you wanted to do. So it's a full package.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
great.
I think so. And I think that the game has offered a lot of options for folks. And I think that the fact that we've been willing to not only, you know, obviously, you know, allow any of its open content to be used under the open game license, but also have been pretty liberally licensing the use of the trade name through our first through the M&M Super Link program, mm-hmm. and now with third edition, what we call the Super Powered by M&M license, which lets other publishers produce their own compatible products.
Oh, cool.
Oh, so then we don't have the Gamma World problem. It's not just a nice set of rule books and core books and a couple modules because you guys are busy doing
right.
the core. Now other people can see. I think that's smart as a lawyer. You know, and when I remember when the D20 system was open for a while and then they shut it down. I shouldn't say D20, mm-hmm. but whatever Wizards of the Coast had, there was that open mm-hmm. license for a while and then they shut it down. It didn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
Well,
but I mean, it's to my mind, it's the opportunity that allows other creatives and game designers to not be stuck in the situation I was, where I had a cool superhero idea and nothing I could do with it.
Right. Do with it, right?
Right, exactly. You know? Well, I think it also does word of mouth, right? I mean, PC games, a lot mm-hmm. of them live and die basically on fan based content, right? I mean.
Absolutely.
You know, and I think this is the same sort of thing that when people, fans can make their own modules and make their own things for the game, mm-hmm. and it really,
yeah.
I think it keeps the game yeah. alive in people's thoughts.
Are you finding a resurgence or a larger swell of superhero-minded RPGers because of the movies, because of I think Marvel with the comics mm-hmm. is a good company going strong? Or is it like, no, Rafe, we've always been here. It's the same good core group. Or are you finding it's reaching different minds like me who might not
have
thought
about it? I think there's a little of both. I think that there are some, you know, fairly hardcore gamers who, you know, are in many ways like the game industry, you know, that, you know, the real uber gamers will play everything
mm-hmm.
Given the opportunity. And so, you know, they've found their way through a lot of games, and I know a lot of our fans, you know, have histories not all that different from mine, where they've been like, oh, I've been gaming for 15 years, and, you know, I've played pretty much every superhero game there is. And I know a lot of others who are, either they started out with the new third edition of D&D or some, you know, later generation game, and have become interested in superhero games because of, you know, the resurgence in superheroes in media, especially in movies and TV, and, you know, are interested in doing something, you know, with that in their gaming. So it seems to be a pretty good mix.
That's great.
Yeah.
So just quick back to some of the game design challenges. I wanted to ask you, what were some of your favorite aspects or things you're most proud of in the mechanics of the game system, and then also what were some of the most challenging elements to design into the game, or did you already kind of touch upon those?
Well, I think that in addition to the core simplicity of the rules, one of my favorite elements of the game is the hero point mechanics that developed for it. And hero points were basically a resource intended to introduce enough flexibility into the game for players to pull off a lot of the more spectacular or difficult things that comic book characters do, but limited enough that it wasn't something that they could do all the time. It was a resource they had to manage carefully. So the way it ended up being, and I really liked this development in the second edition of the game. Initially, we started hero points out as just a set pool. You got X number of points of the game, and you just
right.
you used them up as you played. And it was just your job to sort of husband your resources carefully.
Right.
In the second and in the current edition of the game, we set things up so that the heroes actually start out with just one hero point at the start of the game. At the beginning of every game, you get your one hero point to start off with. And as you encounter challenges and difficulties and dramatic subplots and have your opportunity to do heroic things, you build up more hero points. And basically, the worse your hero's life gets through the course of the adventure, the more hero points you earn. So to use the classic Spider-Man example, you know, when he has to break his date with Mary Jane
right. In
order to go after Dr. Octopus and learns while he's fighting Doc Ock that, you know, Aunt May has had a heart attack and right. That, you know, one of, you know, Doc's flailing tentacles has just broken his camera that he was using to take pictures that were going to pay for her operation. he's racking up hero points so that you know that, you know, Doc Ock is going to get a pasting by the end of this fight.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really cool system. And what were some of the most challenging elements of putting the game together over the years?
Well, the real challenging element of any superhero game is its breadth. Because of their very nature, superhero settings are just so vast and so inclusive. You get, you know, mutant sorceresses, you know, hanging out with cyborgs from the future and, you know, alien telepathic shapeshifters from other dimensions.
Right.
You know, all like in the same, you know, team.
Right.
So you have to be able to cover pretty much anything within, you know, certain, you know, around of reason. So superhero games tend to be all-inclusive, and that involves a lot of work to provide something that has enough breadth to it and enough give to it to create that range of characters, but it's also something approaching balanced and reasonable
right.
in terms
I can
of
imagine.
Gameplay.
Well, you mentioned the universe, and let me ask you this. I think when you mentioned, or I thought I'd heard that you'd worked on some licensed products as well, either for DC or, mm-hmm. or Marvel. What's it like? What's the difference, or what are some of the advantages and disadvantages of working on a licensed product where the universe is defined versus mm-hmm. something as wide open as Mutants and Mastermind, where you can do whatever you want? Is one easier than the other? What are the pros and cons
of
each one?
Well, they're different. They're different. I don't necessarily think that one is easier than the other. Working on a license, and I worked on the DC Adventures role-playing game that Green Ronin just came out with this past summer, which uses the same game engine as Mutants and Masterminds 3rd Edition, the exact same game system.
Oh, great. So sort of like the licensed DC version of Mutants, basically.
Yeah, exactly. It's the licensed DC version of Mutants and Masterminds. The challenge with a license is oftentimes a lot of how do I do this in the context of the game? Because obviously, you know, the last 70 years of DC Comics weren't written with gaming in mind.
The Green Lantern has to work.
Exactly. And the game, in order for it to be a real DC game, you have to be able to play Batman and Green Lantern and Superman.
Yeah, right.
You know, otherwise, you're not doing it right.
Right.
So a lot of it is the context of making that stuff work in the game and just dealing with the vast amount of history and material that you're dealing with in a setting that's that venerable.
Mm-hmm.
You've got, you know, just decades of history to account for. And, you know, it's a lot to fit in. And, you know, it's any true comic book geek, you know, could easily fill volumes talking about even just a few DC characters. And so a lot of times it's really, you know, forcing yourself to focus on the real essential elements. You know, how do you write up Superman's history in 2 pages, you know?
Right.
Well, I don't think I realized that the DC version you guys did was based on Mutants and Masterminds. So let me ask you this question. Were there any heroes? I mean, it must have made you feel pretty good about your M&M system mm-hmm. that you were able to fit it pretty well into DC, but were there any heroes mm-hmm. that were a particular challenge to make them work with the mechanics you already built for Mutants and Masterminds?
There were a few characters that were fairly complex, but I wouldn't say that they were especially difficult. It's certainly not the core DC characters that we included in the rule book. They were pretty straightforward. Honestly, it actually tends more to be villains.
Oh, really?
Who are the hard characters to do, because they tend to be less well defined oftentimes than the heroes.
Give any examples? Who was a tough villain that to fit in there somehow?
Let's see, particularly tough villains. Well, you know, I could actually like Darkseid is a tricky villain in some ways.
Oh yeah, right.
Because he has to be sufficiently powerful, and the exact range of his powers is somewhat unclear. Fortunately, we have a cheat mechanic in Mutants and Masterminds that lets us get away with a lot. So that helps with a lot of character design, because it gives characters a certain give in terms of their capabilities. Mm-hmm. We can cover up a lot of things.
How does that work? I mean, is it like a how does
well,
how
basically
do you cheat?
There's a power stunt mechanic that goes back to those hero points that I was talking about. Mm. And basically, under certain defined circumstances, characters can use one of their existing powers to perform a different effect. You know, the classic example being if a character has the ability to emit really bright light, mm-hmm. they could use a power stunt to create a laser with it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, cool. Damaging effect. And basically, a power stunt simply has a defined cost, either in fatigue from mm-hmm. the effort or spending a hero point. And so it's obviously not something that the character can do all the time, but can reliably do from time to time. And so we can use the power stunt mechanic to sort of hand wave a certain amount of character backgrounds as far as the comics go, because we can be like, oh, well, that thing that guy did in issue 172, that you never saw again, that was a power stunt.
That was a power stunt. Nice.
You know, he doesn't do that all the time. Right. Not really. You know, we'd have to put it in his stats.
Right.
Oh, I see. Okay. Now, are you saying power sun or power stunt?
Stunt. Stunt.
Yeah. Okay. Stunt. Okay, got it.
Yeah.
That's cool. That's cool. So I didn't. That's neat to know that there's a DC version. So Mutants Masterminds is now on the third edition, and that when did that come out? Is that pretty recent?
It's the third edition Heroes Handbook actually just hit stores.
Well, there you go. Brand new.
I've seen it, so you know, it's out there.
So what has evolved in the game from first to second, and more importantly, what's the new hotness in third? What are your fans really excited about seeing in third right now?
Well, basically, the third edition is sort of a more refined version of second edition. First to second edition was a fairly significant shift that I think really brought the game together. First edition was good, but had a lot of rough edges to it.
Mm-hmm.
And some people find that very charming. And, you know, me, you know, I tend to think that game designers are never entirely happy with their projects. You know, if it were up to them, we'd never finish.
Right.
Right, right.
You know, we'd tinker with them forever. But eventually, you know, somebody, you know, hopefully their editor has to say, you know, no, you have a deadline. We must publish this book.
Yeah.
So I find that the second edition holds together a lot better as a complete game. Mm-hmm. And the third edition of the game is really just a refinement of a lot of that. The reason it came about was because second edition was doing very, very well and had a good 5 or 6 years of solid support and product.
Mm-hmm.
And when Green Ronin got the DC license to do a DC Mutants and Masterminds game, DC wanted a complete game. They didn't want us to do a DC source book for Mutants and Masterminds.
Right.
They wanted a DC-branded game. So we had to come out with a new edition of the rule book, essentially, in order to produce the game. So it was a great opportunity for us to, polish up the chrome of Mutants and Masterminds. We particularly kind of refined and standardized a lot of just like the terminology in the game, because the D20 license is effectively gone.
Right.
So there was really a lot less need to use a lot of the same terminology that was common in the D20 market. So we refined a lot of things and changed some of the terminology around. We changed the names of a couple of the ability scores. So we like changed charisma to presence, which I always thought worked better for superheroes. Things like that. Removed some things that were kind of D&D-isms.
Now, were the changes so fundamental that the second edition source books don't work any longer, or can you still kind of make them work?
No, actually, the numbers, the numerical values in the second edition source books are pretty much still dead on.
Oh, good. Okay.
And so it's actually fairly easy to use second edition characters and stats in third edition. Some of it is just getting used to the shifts in terminology, but the essential game values are all there.
Okay.
Those really didn't change.
So, see, Ian could run your game in third edition. See there?
That's what I keep telling him.
So, that's cool.
That's what I keep telling him. How about, I want to make sure that we don't run over on time, as we promised. What tips? What tip do you have for me who, if I'm sitting here creating in my mind, I want to have a character who can climb walls, but instead of shoot webs, he's going to shoot ice. And I think, Rafe, you're just going to be Spider-Man mixed with Iceman. Is it, go ahead, be Spider-Man mixed with that. Like, embrace that or go with it? Because what tips do you have?
I think that's a perfectly viable option. We've got a range of character creation options in the game. The basic character creation system is basically a point-based building system where you spend a budget of points to put together the character you want. It's very detailed, and it allows you pretty much complete control over how your character is designed. However, it is somewhat time-consuming just because you have to sit down and allocate all those points and figure out where everything goes and add everything up. It's great for folks who want to do detailed character design, but
I was going to say, which is fun in and of itself.
Which I was going to say, for a lot of people, is an entire hobby unto itself.
Right.
Mm-hmm. All you have to do is visit the Atomic Think Tank forums for Green Ronin, and you can see entire threads devoted to character design. We've had people post literally hundreds of characters on our forums. But we also have a couple of other design options that we've provided for the game to make things to provide some different options, essentially. The core rulebook has a set of character archetypes in it, which are basically quick pre-built characters that have a few customizing options to them that are great for somebody who has a general kind of archetype of the type of character they want to play, and could say, I want a speedster character, I want a super strong character, I want a guy who can fly and throw energy blasts.
Mm-hmm.
We've got all of those and more. In the archetypes. And
that's
all
smart.
Somebody has to do is say, I want to play that guy. And you write down his stats. Some of them will say, pick one of these three options.
Mm-hmm.
And you're good to go. In the sort of in-between stage of those two, in the Mutants and Mastermind Game Masters kit, which is in pre-order right now, PDF, the electronic version, is on sale, but the print version is still at the printer. It's the Game Master screen and a character creation booklet that's packaged with it, which is basically a 48-page book of tables for building superhero characters. And it basically has 20... sets of tables for 20 different archetypes.
Nice.
And you can randomly roll every element of the character if you want, from what archetype they are to what their abilities are to what their powers are. Or you can just go through the table, sets of tables, and pick things from them, because they all add up to the same starting value.
Almost like a flow chart of character design. You just kind of go through the flow chart.
Exactly.
And you'll get a
giant extended flow chart of character design.
That's cool. That's great. So you have all kinds of choices. If you're really hardcore, you can get all the, you know, the nooks and crannies out and make exactly what you want, or pick an archetype or use the flowchart. That's really
No wonder the people like it, because it gives all of those options.
Yeah.
And I've got to say too, I really like the concept that it's PDF. Now, I'm a book guy. I'm still old enough where I want to hold my book and see the color.
Sure.
But
sure.
For somebody who's a little more cost conscious or says, I want this now, or I like to be able to manipulate it on my screen, I like the fact that it's not just PDF is what I'm trying to say.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, we've had a lot of good results with selling electronic versions of our products as well. But we've got, the traditional print product coming out all
That's
the time.
That's good.
Well, now, before we let you go, I know Rafe's got one more question for you. But what are the current... any current projects you're working on you can tell us about? What's the new hotness coming from you guys?
Well, the current stuff from Mutants and Masterminds is we're doing a couple of lines of short PDF products that we just launched. One is called Threat Report, which basically is a villain a week that we're doing in electronic format.
Well, that's fun. So you just pick up a new villain and try them out against your players, right?
Basically, every week you pay 99 cents, you get a new villain, and it's usually about 3 pages of content, complete game stats, illustration, some adventure ideas.
How awesome is that? That's great.
It's a bargain.
Great idea.
And we also just launched an adventure series called Emerald City Knights. That is a 6-part Mutants and Masterminds adventure. It's basically a mini campaign that is all about a West Coast city in the same universe as Freedom City that has basically been sort of largely ignored up until now. And origin level event happens there at the start of the series that kicks off all sorts of activity and gives the player characters the chance to basically become the local hometown heroes and really get enmeshed in this plot that they quickly discover has very wide-reaching potential.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that sounds cool.
And we're publishing... basically a chapter of that adventure every 5 or 6 weeks.
Neat.
Well, that's a neat idea.
It's almost like a serialized novel or story, but it's a serialized adventure.
Yeah,
that's really
exactly.
cool. The players can't read ahead on you. That's awesome.
The prologue of that adventure is available for free on the Green Running site.
Oh, neat.
Cool. All right. Well, Russ, is this the last question?
Yeah, you got to hit him with your favorite question there.
All right, my last question. So I'm the comic reader fanboy. I mean, Russ and Craig read them too, but I collect them, monthly as they go along. What are your favorite comic reads right now?
Oh, geez. Right now, I'm really enjoying a lot of Geoff Johns' Green Lantern stuff.
Okay. Yep.
I like the Green Lantern.
So I've been pretty much reading everything since he did Return of Hal Jordan. And what other books I'm thinking? I'm trying to think of books I picked up at the store last week.
Mm-hmm.
I love the new Zatanna book.
I haven't heard of that one.
It's a lot of fun.
What's it called?
And it's just Zatanna.
Zatanna, huh?
Zatanna with a Z.
Yeah.
Oh, Z. Okay.
Yeah. I tend to be a DC guy for a lot of stuff.
Okay.
So it tends to be a lot of the DC books, Justice League and those sorts of things. Although I do have to say I'm really enjoying the new Avengers cartoon.
Okay.
Oh, isn't it good? I enjoy that too. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
I got my girls watching it now. It's
pretty awesome.
It is fantastic for kids. It's great. It's really well done.
Yeah.
So, and my last question before I let you go is, the new Green Lantern movie, fantastic or flop? What do you think?
Cautiously optimistic.
He takes the middle road.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, he's a DC guy.
He's got a
more of a Marvel guy.
I gotta hope it's good because I really like Green Lantern and I really want it to be.
Me too, but the previews...
I'm sorry to say that, I don't know, maybe DC's managed to turn it around with Dark Knight and the like, but
DC's
track record with live-action movies is not great.
Not so good. Yeah, right. Well, Steve, thank you for so much for joining us for a whole hour here and letting us know what how you got started and all the goodness that is Mutants and Masterminds. Thanks for spending some time with us.
Yeah, thank you.
My pleasure, guys.
This Did You Ever Notice is brought to you by a woman who went through Cold War-era espionage-like lengths to keep what you were about to hear a secret until, well, until you were about to hear it. Happy 25th birthday to the nerdiest nerd face I know. I'll listen to your lengthy rules, explanations, painting technique ideas, and overly excited tech jargon for at least another 25, but only because you're cute. Love, your adoring gamer wife, Liz. That's a great one, Liz, and worth all the twists and turns. And truly fitting, interestingly enough, for my topic tonight. Did you ever notice how some groups are nicer than others? And some groups have specific ideas that are wrapped around themselves by other people? When I hear one of my students say something derogatory about a group or an affiliation, which happens more often than I would like, I generally stop all the discussion, point out what was said, and then I pass along this little truism. Just about every group I've ever met has had nearly identical ratios of good people to bad, smart people to dumb, polite people to rude. And I believe that to the bottom of my soul. You cannot judge a person based upon their ethnicity, their gender, their hair color, lest I probably wouldn't be married to a redhead, or any of the thousands of other identifiers that people don't choose for themselves. Now, the funny thing is, however, that I think you can judge a person a little bit based upon the identifiers they choose for themselves. For instance, a bunch of stupid movies notwithstanding, I think if you're in a gang, I'm probably not going to like you. Likewise, the erroneous plot structure of Pretty Woman, but I digress. See, folks all around the world all the time make snap judgments, usually to the negative, about gamers. I get it all the time in my classroom when it comes out, usually because some student has Googled my name, an alarmingly increasing habit, that I'm one of the hosts of a podcast about gaming. I'm sure you've heard all of the statements, so I won't belabor the point here. Suffice to say that folks think some very strange things about us. Interestingly enough, we often identify folks within our own ranks that support some of these ideas. Like many stereotypes, there is at least a small seed of truth at the center. How many cons have you been driven out of the building for a quick breath of fresh air and unalloyed with Ode to Gamer? Or how about the black t-shirt thing or hammerheads? But you know what? I happen to think that, given only the identifier gamer to work with, I'd almost always assume the best about a person until they proved otherwise. Generally, we all like similar things. You're almost always going to have something you can talk about, whether it's games or movies or TV shows or what have you. And even with within the stereotype, often supported with anecdotal evidence, most gamers are at least marginally sociable, especially with each other, or they wouldn't like to play games. But nothing reminds me of how positive the gaming community can be, and is undoubtedly in a very high ratio to the not so much, as when we're trying to run something, either a charity event or something, with the D6 generation, and we reach out for help from the community. Just this exact thing is happening right now as Rafe and I prepare for our big trip to Adepticon and our D6 generation board game party on Sunday night. See, you can't really have a board game party without, well, board games. And although Rafe and I own quite a few, we're not going to be toting them all the way out to Chicago and back for a one-night event. Heck, we don't even dent our own collections to bring them to bring things to Myriad on a Tuesday night for the love of something imminently lovable. So, we were faced with the dilemma, how do you run a board game party without bringing board games? And of course, we immediately started to think about the folks that we knew that might be willing to help us out. We reached out, and folks responded with excitement and support that we always feel is humbling. And you know what? It's almost always the little guys that really step up. As one of the most clear and obvious examples, Steven and our other friends at Stronghold Games are donating 3 copies of Survive Escape from Atlantis and 3 copies of Code 777. And the folks that attend the party will have a chance to win both of those games. Just so you're fully appreciative of what that means for a really young fledgling company, and remember, Stronghold isn't even a year old, if you factor the size and the financial situation and the sales of Stronghold and the like data of, say, Fantasy Flight Games,
FFG would have to donate roughly $127,000 worth of product, retail worth of product, to equal the donation of Stronghold Games' value to itself. Now that's stepping up. Kurt at Smirk and Dagger Games is also supporting us big time with 3 copies of Cutthroat Caverns and 3 copies of Hexex. Again, a very generous gift of support from another of our favorite little guys. All of these games are a blast and will be great for all the folks who, tired after a long weekend of minigame wars from Ancients to Astronomicals, will be looking for a chance to wind down a little bit and relax with some friends. Another friend of the show that's really step up is Gamesalute.com. Dan, the chief experience officer at Game Salute, has been working overtime reaching out to his contacts in the gaming industry for help as well. The kind folks at Rio Grande Games, for instance, are stepping up, not to mention another blast from the past, Compound Fun, the purveyors of the fine minigame Arcane Legions. Unfortunately, we weren't able to really put anything together because they wanted a full demo, which would have been cool. That would have been an awesome game to try to resurrect the interest in. But we only have 6 days before we leave for Chicago, and that's really not enough time for us to wedge something else into our schedule. But somebody else may take them up on that, because it was a very generous offer. And that's not to say that Fantasy Flight isn't helping as well, because they're sending a nice bundle of games also. But that's just my point, really. In what industry would so many folks step up so quickly and completely for a little podcast trying to put together a party half a continent away? And all of this was done in the last 2 days. Those of you who work in business can attest, not very much gets done that fast. And if you worked in the public sector, then you really know that nothing gets done that fast there. And yet, here they all are, all these owners and managers jumping in to help us make a really great fun night for the folks who will be staying late at a con far from the central business locations of all of them. And that's another thing. They're all paying to ship these games out to the con. It's really amazing and humbling, and it's going to make for a great night in Chicago. And it just fuels my opinion that gamers, in general, are great people. Even the hammerheads, sometimes. And I did want to give them all a shout-out, plus the Adepticon Council, who invited us to do this, and all the folks who have contacted us over the past few months, excited to meet up with us in the Windy City. I know at least one Geek Nation tour from Australia is going to be there, and we've got several listeners in that group, and we can't wait to meet them. And people from all over the country are going to be there. So what is this big event? Have we mentioned it actually in its entirety yet? Because I forget. Basically, it's tradition for the volunteers of Adepticon, as well as any convention goers who are staying through for whatever reason Sunday and into Monday, to have a big poker game, a tournament actually. But there are 2 things about poker tournaments. 1, not everyone likes to play poker, me for example. And 2, once you're out in a poker tournament, you're out for good and you don't have anything else to do. But now, there's us. We'll be having a big party with all these games and more all night long while the poker tournament is taking place. Rafe and I will be playing in these games, various games, until they kick us out, with anyone who wants to. It's like a massive meet and greet with the added fun of dozens of board games you can play and even win as take-home prizes. It's easily the biggest event we at the D6 Generation have ever run, and we're really excited about it. Unfortunately, Russ can't come because someone's brother's sister's cousin twice removed is getting married. Just kidding, Nicole. But he's working really hard himself to see that we have everything we need to make that weekend, and our party in particular, a big success. And we will miss him when we're out there. So if you're going to be in Chicago the weekend of the 1st through the 4th of April, and no, nothing about this is an April Fool's joke, stop on by. And remember, all the folks who are coming together to make this night possible, because they are all awesome. And they're all gamers, and that can't be a complete coincidence, can it? That's about all I've got this time around. Thanks for listening, and good night.
Achievement unlocked! You've made it to the end of another D6 Generation episode, the podcast whose humor has universally been acclaimed as not too horrible. please let us know what you thought of the show by either emailing us at info@thed6generation.com or by posting in our official D6G episode thread at the top of the DACA discussions forum on DACADACA.com. If for some inexplicable reason you actually enjoyed this show, you can help others find out about it by leaving positive reviews on iTunes. See you in 2 weeks. Thanks for listening, and happy gaming.
The theme from Total Fangirl comes from the soundtrack of The Last Night on Earth, The Zombie Game, courtesy of Flying Frog Productions, and is a composition of Mary Beth Magalanes.
Dear D6G, I write to you to tell you of the three games that I would take from the sinking island and with me bring safely to the other shore, so I need never fear to be without the gaming fun that I hold so dear. Now first and foremost I would save a dungeon crawling game. This genre early on in youth my heart and soul did claim. Of all the game experiences truly are the best. Those tales of heroes brave and bold pursuing a deadly quest. The first game I would take therefore is Wonderful Descent, the loss of which I surely would most grievously lament. This dungeon-crawling beauty is the pinnacle of fun. I'd haul its coffin anywhere, though it weighs a metric ton. While first among the fancies of the geek is fantasy, the second passion definitely is technology. So lasers and conveyor belts must be part of the mix of titles from which I would henceforth get my gaming fix. Thus Robo-Rally I would also rescue from the isle. I love it for its wackiness and chaotic style. 8 robots armed and dangerous sure look a deadly horde, yet more oft than not you'll see them go careening off the board. Now sailing from Atlantis I could end up anywhere, so at least one game I'd rescue that is lighter fare, because to many folks our hobby is entirely new. Not everyone's a gamer geek, it's sad, I know, but true. So Pitch Car is the third game that I take, there's no debate. It brings light-hearted flicking fun and plays up to 8. Its zooming cars and ease of play will bring into the fold of our beloved gaming culture people young and old. With these three games I'd brave the seas around Atlantis' shore, all teeming with enormous squids, blue whales, black sharks, and more. And if on the horizon a sea monster should appear, I'll spend a movement point and jump, praying a dolphin's near.